Hello humans, no self-defenders, silent experiencers, karma wizards and ontological agnostics. This is Ryan Ferris and welcome to The Good Timeline. The Good Timeline is the place where we explore the global trend of transhumanism, which is the self-directed transformation of Homo sapien humans into a post-human world and how we might best make that transition. Before we begin, if you haven't heard the first interview with Daniel, which is episode number 16, I highly recommend checking that out before listening to this, especially if you're new to Buddhism. In the first episode, we cover many of the fundamentals of Buddhism and meditative practice. Knowing these fundamentals and some of the vocabulary will be very helpful in understanding what we are discussing in this episode. So for those that don't know, Daniel Ingram is a high-level meditator, the author of Mastering the Core Teachings of the Buddha, and an emergency medicine physician. In my humble opinion, meditative masters, monks, yogis, etc. are the OG original transhumanists. And as far as I can see, even in modern times, they still seem to be the group that have been the most successful in transcending many of our hunter-gatherer Darwinian human concerns and limitations. In this episode, we discuss some of the higher reaches of what can be achieved through dedicated practice, plus a bunch of other topics that academia has barely begun to map out. Enjoy.
I've got a lot of higher level, very interesting stuff to explore with you today, but I thought we could start with something a little lighter, and I thought that could be humor. You've spoken in your book, and we spoke about it in our last chat, about the importance of humor in Buddhism and in the spiritual path, and that many teachers seem to have a well-developed sense of humor. Could you expand on this a bit and perhaps relay a story or two from teachers that you've encountered that have a good sense of humor?
Yeah, so there's a real mix actually in terms of sense of humor. So I've trained with some people who are extremely serious. I've trained with some people who are very boring. I've trained with some people who are not good storytellers. And I've trained with some people who are really pretty funny, quirky, kind of goofy. Christopher Titmuss in particular tells a lot of very funny stories. Some of his funny stories were actually talking about interactions with his daughter, where like he said that, you know, she was like a Zen master and stepped into his life and would show him all the places where perhaps he could benefit from some more spiritual maturity, or showed him where he had issues. He was sort of like bemoanedly laughing at how hard it was to watch her come in whenever she turned the drinking age in England and went out to the pubs and came staggering back in at 3 a.m. And this is his little girl, and watching that happen. And he was laughing about it, but you could tell it really hit him hard when he was watching that happen to his child. So he said it in a really funny way, but yet a serious, respectful way as well. So those are some of the, you know, he was one of the funnier ones as they go, but actually a reasonable number were not funny. They were just serious, straightforward, didn't tell jokes. But I remember what is really surprising, this guy I used to sit with at the Nipponji temple in Bodh Gaya, India, and we would go and they would chant and ring bells and do this beautiful little ceremony, and then we would all sit for an hour. And then sometimes, but not every night, he would give a Dharma talk. And one of the nights, he started out, and he was Japanese, although he was there in India at this temple, and he started out,
"Some people say there is mind. I say there is no mind, but never mind."
Anyway, and it was like listening to Yoda try to tell a joke or something. And it was like, but it was like, I was about to fall on the floor. It was so funny. Like he laughed a little bit, that, and then it just stopped, cut off. And it was like, anyway, at the moment it was hilarious. I don't know what you think now, but in the context, it was such a departure from what he typically did, which was very serious. And so some of like, yeah, the moments of humor were even better when they were generally pretty dry. So
yeah.
Yeah.
So he was aware that that moment was humorous.
Yeah. Yeah. Cause yeah. He went, ha, ha, ha,
right. Okay.
And laughed at his own joke.
Did you ever try and coax humor out of the less humorful teachers?
Most of the time I was studying with them, I didn't really have the sense of confidence or position or place to do that. So usually not. I usually just let them be themselves.
Yeah, no, fair enough.
It's hailing here now, by the way, if you hear some sounds in the background.
So. We'll just add the brackets ASMR to this episode and people can get into it. So experiential high-level meditation. So let's just dive straight in there. There's a few things I'd like to explore because last time we talked, we sort of did more of an intro chat and went through sort of the first part of your book and a bunch of the sort of fundamental principles of Buddhism. But this time I think it'd be fun to explore some of the more out there parts because I find your perspective is very rational and quite frankly, I believe what you're saying. Whereas a bunch of other people that I've met that are on spiritual paths, as you might say, I find them, a lot of them less believable. So with that in mind, let's jump into the jhanas. And I realize that we could talk about these for an entire podcast, but let's maybe just choose a couple of levels to explore. So would you better explain what a jhana is and then perhaps what one might experience at some of the lower and mid and high level jhanas?
Okay, so I'll give you the basic theory to start with. A jhana is a state of mind that is classically cultivated in Buddhism, though they were pre-Buddhist. The Buddhists learned the jhanas from his Brahmin Hindu teachers. I guess they wouldn't have been called Hindus then, but Brahmin teachers back then. And they are refined states of mind that have specific qualities, and they progress in a particular sequence. And these jhanas are not actually Buddhist or Hindu. They're just actually how attention progresses when one begins to really learn to concentrate the mind deeply. And they're just actually sort of what happens as the thing goes. So they're more descriptive of something in human attentional physiology or embryology or development than they are anything specific to any tradition. And you find them mentioned in various forms in basically all the contemplative traditions. So to start with, the first jhana classically would be described as, you know, with applied and sustained effort and attention, one dwells in the first jhana, which has rapture and happiness born of seclusion from the hindrances. And the hindrances are things like doubt, restlessness, fear, desire, anger, irritation, etc. And so there's like a shift, and all of a sudden you find yourself in a place that's more quiet, more calm, more focused, more stable, more pleasant, and more removed from your previous meditation difficulties. The second jhana classically is described as with the dropping of applied and sustained effort. So the thing about the first jhana is you need to be able to hold your attention very stably on something, you know, with some effort. You can hold your mind there as long as you continue to apply the effort. And the second jhana, that drops away, and there's much more of a sense of automaticity. Now, it's not 100% perfectly automatic, but it's vastly easier. It's kind of like turning a Tesla to autopilot. Occasionally, you may have to do some stuff, but you don't have to do much. The jhanas kind of drive themselves. And so with a lot of the focus going away from holding the effort into the concentrated state, the rapture and happiness can really bloom. And then traditionally, the third jhana would be with the dropping of rapture, there's cool bodily bliss and mindfulness and equanimity. And so the third jhana is wider. It's sometimes described as like, you know, a cool pool, or it's very tranquil. And it's wider, it's more calm, it's less sort of impressively blissful or enjoyable than the second jhana, which is sort of the peak of enjoyment. But it's got a sort of subtle cool bliss to it. And then the fourth traditionally is said with the dropping of, you know, the subtle bodily, you know, cool bliss, there's equanimity with mindfulness sort of considered to be perfected because of the strength of equanimity, even if it isn't necessarily that predominant. And those are the first four jhanas. Now, there are four formless realms after those: boundless space, boundless consciousness, nothingness, neither perception nor non-perception, that we could talk about in a bit. But I'll stick with the formed ones first. And I think the most important thing that one could learn about the jhanas is to think about them dimensionally rather than categorically. So some people, depending on the person and the way they're training and just that day and how their body and mind are and what object they're using, et cetera, and their previous training, may go into the jhanas and have a very different experience of them than someone else, because with different objects, with different emphases, they can look pretty different. And one time you get into the second jhana, it's, you know, orgasmic level bliss. And another time, yeah, it's blissful, but it's not like you're, you know, like, okay, this is too much. I can't take that much. Or, and sometimes the bliss might be subtle. For example, if you weren't really even concentrating on your body and instead your jhanic object was a mantra or was a visualization where you're really not attending much to your body at all, you might really not really notice the bliss and rapture that much unless the attention turns back towards those objects momentarily. And so it's being able to think of jhanas more dimensionally than categorically, meaning shades of gray about how strong each of the factors are that day or at that moment in the jhana, is more helpful than just thinking of them as sort of black and white categories where some teachers sort of think of them that way. And for some people, sometimes they can develop that way. You suddenly strongly shift into this very specific state that has specific qualities, and you can learn to do that again and again. But that doesn't happen for everybody. And so I think it's helpful to have a kind of an open mind about the range of ways these can present. And I'm sorry about the hail noise. It's really loud here. I don't know what it sounds like through the microphone.
Oh, it's just pleasantly relaxing.
Cool.
Okay. This whole conversation is going to be a bit more jumpy than our first one, and it's going to go over a bunch of stuff. So let's just jump into the next four and explore those a wee bit.
So after one gets to equanimity, equanimity is a platform from which a lot of cool things can happen. So fourth jhana is, you know, its focus is equanimity, which is sort of broad. It's very even in its treatment of experiences. It tends to have a very sort of neutral body tone, but there's something nice about that neutrality. And one from the fourth jhana has a number of options. One could actually attain to very deep transformative insights, like what are called cessations or fruitions. This is how you would get, say, stream entry or a next path. These are stages of awakening. And that can happen out of jhana because one can get clear enough and balanced enough and even enough in one's treatment of all of one's experience that one comes to something called conformity knowledge, which is where it feels like all the attention centers of the brain suddenly perfectly converge on a complete moment. All of the, you know, the room you're in, all of your experience of your body, or your mind, or whatever your object is at that moment, it feels like attention is finally perfectly aligned with the object, and that can cause an initial awakening. And although the diagnostic criteria for it are complicated, that's not the only one, so you need to be a little careful about diagnosing this. But the other options are one can be in the fourth jhana, which has the quality of sort of a broad openness, and if one notices that broad openness and sort of disinclines from the body a little bit and becomes a little disenchanted with form, which means you've generally the body and sights and sounds and stuff, then the mind can tune into that openness. And if you tune that way long enough, all of a sudden flip into what feels like vast open space. There's no body, or maybe very subtle body if you're in kind of a light version of it. Although the body can disappear at much lower stages in jhanas too, just because your body disappears doesn't mean you're necessarily in boundless space. But all of a sudden, if you're really in the real thing, there's this wide open vastness. And it's kind of like at its best. So imagine that you were in a spaceship looking out a big, you know, portal at space. And then you took away the spaceship. And then you took away your body. And then you took away the stars. Except somehow you can tell there is space without the reference points of stars. That's kind of what it's like. And then boundless consciousness is basically just that, with this sense of sort of light or consciousness that goes through the whole thing very evenly. Again, body and everything gone if you get it really clean. And then nothingness, which is the seventh jhana, is very much the reverse of that. So it's kind of paradoxical. All of a sudden, the mind becomes disenchanted with consciousness, with luminosity, with that sense of open vastness, and it tunes from that. And all of a sudden you tune to the quality of nothingness, which sounds like a very abstract quality, but you can actually turn, it's almost like tuning to the platonic universal of nothingness, the sense my body, my mind is not really tuned to anything except that quality of not being tuned to anything, which it turns out is actually a quality you can tune to. So it's paradoxical, but that's how these things kind of get. And then if you like paradoxical language, you'll really like the next one, which is called neither perception nor yet non-perception, or the eighth jhana, which performs exactly as advertised. It's like you're attending to nothingness as the object of concentration, and then you detuned even from that. And at that point, it's very hard to explain what it is you're tuned or not tuned to. These are very, very rarefied abstract states that you kind of have to have been in to really appreciate. But the names of them are very accurate. So that's the nice thing about them. At least there's truth in advertising for these things. Though it's common for people to get into lesser states that are just vague or not well developed and think, oh, I wasn't really attending to things well. So that must be neither perception nor yet non-perception. But neither perception nor yet non-perception generally arises after the sequence of the previous three, and it's actually a very refined, precise state. So it's easy to misdiagnose it, but it's also an attainable thing that people can learn to do.
What would be the best way for people to have these states sort of diagnosed, or diagnosed is perhaps not the right word, but recognized by somebody that has attained them already? I mean, I imagine you guys are doing that at the Dharma Overground, but how would one find a good teacher that could assist them in knowing which stage that they're at or what they have previously experienced or attained?
Yeah. So as I've recently been saying, unfortunately, while I love the Dharma Overground and I think it's incredibly valuable and it's nice to have some reference points because it's more reference points than most people have, the range of people who are replying to posts, they're vary. So some people have gotten into stages and states that are not as refined or as precise, and they think they have gotten into them. So not everybody who posts there in response to questions is necessarily an adept at stage and state diagnosis. Mm-hmm. But it's also kind of like, it's sort of like evaluating a chef based on how well they tweet.
Okay.
Like, it's not so easy, right? And maybe you can get a sense from how well a chef tweets, how good their food is. But way better, if you're really going to do this right, go on a retreat with people who know how to do this. And unfortunately, there are not that many of those people. I'm sorry, they're hard to find, but you go to Burma, you can find them. You go to Sri Lanka, you can find them. There are some in the US, a few. You could talk to Lee Brazington, there's some others, a few. If you're really in a place where you're at that level where you need these things diagnosed, particularly the formless realms, then you're going to have to really kind of seek out some teachers, figure out how to get on retreat with them, figure out how to convince them you're even worthy of having those kinds of discussions, which not a lot of the traditional teachers will go there until they've really watched you practice and you've convinced them through a lot of really good practice and good phenomenological descriptions that didn't use those terms. If they get to watch the progression on retreat, that makes it a lot easier, where you've actually seen them go through it. You've seen the range of how they are. You're actually there in the room with them. That's about as close in this business as you can get, unless you have some unusual powers. That's a whole nother topic. We're really going to the edge now. But, to be able to tell what's going on with someone is not easy. And it's much easier if you can really watch it all unfold on retreat, get a sense of how they use language, really confirm stuff, go through it and see if they can do it again and again, watch the deepening of these things. And then, it's still an imprecise business, but you can get a better sense. And hopefully that kind of training will also give them a better sense as they interact with you or whoever the teacher is, that they will, of what the range is, of what's possible. And yeah, so that's how this is done at the better end.
Do you have any good starting points as far as communities or traditions? You've mentioned a couple of places there, but...
Yeah, so you could hang out with the Power Out kids, Shaila Catherine, Bhante Gunaratana, definitely a good person if you want it. He's old, but he's still pretty sharp, I hear. I haven't seen him in a long time, but he's a delightful person. You could go to Burma. There's some other people in, if you were in even in Mahasi traditions, there are, reasonable number of the higher level Mahasi teachers would be good at this. I'm sure there are some teachers in Sri Lanka who could do this pretty well, but I don't know them personally. Yeah, you're going to have to look around because this is, nearly everything you're going to find on the web in terms of advertising a teacher or a course is not going to say formless realms. This mm-hmm. is sort of like graduate or postdoc programs, like PhD programs. You get in through a network. They're not advertised all over the place. You're not going to find them. You're going to have to do some digging to figure out, if you were going to study advanced quantum mechanics or something, at the PhD or graduate level, which is kind of what we're talking about now when we talk about formless realms, you're going to have to hunt around. It's not going to be easy. This is not going to be available in a lot of universities or, undergraduate institutions or, elementary school. So most retreat centers in that same kind of way, using that educational analogy, that's just not what they are. They're elementary school or junior high or high school, or if you're lucky, college. Yeah. But this is more than that. So it's going to be much smaller circles and harder to find networks. But yeah, if you hunt around, you can find them.
You mentioned stream entry before. So what is stream entry?
Yeah, so stream entry is a traditional insight stage. This is using very sort of Theravada language, although you find the Mahayana talking about this too, the Tibetans reference the Theravada maps. And stream entry, basically you go through the stages of insight, which, you go through, you see thoughts as thoughts, you notice thoughts come and go, experiences come and go, you start noticing feelings and deeper structures and some of your scary aspects, and the dark night stages kind of come and go, and then you get to equanimity about all that, and you notice things like space and consciousness and wonder and core qualities that really seem to be you arising and vanishing and coming and going and flowing. And when you get good at that, if you get good enough at that, eventually the mind will come to something called conformity knowledge. And in conformity knowledge, for a brief moment, which is, a fraction of a second, the mind totally converges perfectly on a moment. All the attention centers are finally undivided. There's nothing holding back. And one clearly comprehends the arising and vanishing on its own, and that sort of weird dualistic tension quality that's sometimes referred to as dukkha or suffering. You perceive that perfectly for a moment. That flashes like three times in various ways, and then you disappear, and then you reappear, and something in that process changes something about the brain. And stream enterers, so there's all kinds of performance criteria for evaluating whether or not you're a stream enterer, and diagnosing stream entry is actually very much like diagnosing jhanas. It's complicated. Mm. It's easy to fool yourself. There's a lot of mimics and lower sort of peak experiences and equanimity experiences that can delude lots and lots of people into thinking whatever they had was stream entry or awakening or some higher awakening or whatever. But most of the time it's not. But anyway, you can read all about this in the book. Yeah. But The point is that assuming you actually got the thing, a true stream enterer has a number of qualities. First, they have actually seen or perceived, don't necessarily mean to use visual terms all the time. I'm a slightly visual person. So if I say seen, that could be perceived, just translate in your brain. They've perceived the sum total of space, consciousness, themselves, time, everything truly vanish and truly reappear. So while they might not be able to articulate that that means they are impermanent or there is no such thing as permanent consciousness or whatever, they've perceived that for an instant. So we now get into the problem of they might have the attainments, but that doesn't necessarily mean they'll describe it necessarily the same way as someone else. It would be like if five people walked up to a Ferrari and you read all their descriptions of it. Yeah, a lot of people might say red or whatever and four wheels, but they could focus on entirely different things and you might not know they were all describing the same car, even though it was the same Ferrari. In the same kind of way, five people describing stream entry wouldn't necessarily describe it in exactly the same terms, which can be confusing, but there are some common elements. So they can instantly, at a whim, drop down into a meditative state. And there are other people who can do that, so that's not necessarily diagnostic for stream entry, but they can drop into the stages of insight. They now start meditating at a level of the arising and passing away, whereas most people start meditating, they sit down, they have to deal with some hindrances, they finally might see thoughts as thoughts, that's the first insight, mind and body, and then maybe they start seeing intentions and, blah, 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 and they go through cause and effect and they start with, but a stream enterer instantly drops into the arising and passing away. It might last a second or two, they're out into dissolution, up into the dark night stages to equanimity, and then hopefully they can get repeat fruitions where they get the sort of the reality disappears, reappears, and the sort of feelings like chemical reward almost. It feels like your brain has been reset in this delightful way. It feels very clean, and it shows you something super cool about the true nature of reality and space at this high level of perceptual clarity, which is neat. That said, they may, still have all kinds of issues. They may not understand exactly what's happened to them. They can still not necessarily be nice people. They can still be confused. They still have, at least three more paths to go, depending on how you want to label and number things. And so it's kind of like getting into college, basically, from my point of view. It's like you graduate high school when you get to equanimity reliably, and stream entry is like getting into college and then becoming a lowly freshman. So there's a ton to learn after that. But they have this real advantage because they've what we call entered the stream. And that's why it's called this. They now cycle rapidly. The stages of insight happen to them, and they happen to them much more rapidly and powerfully and reliably than people who are not stream enters. They're in the current of the thing. This is like previous people were like paddling around on shore, you know, like, and these are people who have gone out into the deeper water where all of a sudden the current has taken them, and how fast the current will move them exactly and exactly where they'll go. It's complicated, but they're in the sweep of the thing. And so they'll cycle much more rapidly, go through insight stages more rapidly, progress to deeper layers of mind. And it's sort of like getting into a, like it's like you, if you make it into college, there's a high probability you'll make it farther in your education. Whereas if you don't, you just kind of stop there. And so this is like a getting in through some important door of further spiritual progress, at least on the front that insight produces, which is not the be all and end all of all spiritual accomplishments. But anyway, so that's my sort of hedged, but hopefully slightly useful thing about stream entry. They also, most people get the sense there's some suffering reduced, right? There's something better. Like this is an upgrade. They feel like their minds are upgraded. They have a clearer perception of thoughts as thoughts. That layer of mind that they just awakened feels much more manageable. There are other layers of mind that may remain totally unawakened, but that layer of mind usually feels easy. Like whereas the Dark Knight stages may have been very challenging before, you know, and take weeks to months to go through, they might pass through them in 15 minutes and not really notice them that much and get up to equanimity. You know, so that layer of mind gets some level of mastery to it in terms of clearer, sort of automatic, helpful perception. Again, that doesn't apply to all their other layers of mind. There tend to be lots, but at least for that one that they have been dealing with. And so a lot of people go, wow, that was a major upgrade. This is seriously better. I mean, it's kind of like, you know, when I went from like lion to snow lion on my Mac. Snow lion was great. Like, was it the be all and end all? No. Like, but was it better? Yeah, it was really good. I like snow lion. So you get the idea.
Yeah. No, great. Thanks. Be keen to get into the other paths in a wee while, but first, kind of like to intersect this and hear your thoughts on a parallel. Are you familiar with 5-MeO DMT? It's a psychedelic compound.
Yeah, 5-MeO DMT. Yes. So that's found in toad, basically, with bufotenin or however you say it. Curiously enough, I actually may be involved in an IV DMT and 5-MeO DMT study at the Imperial College London.
Wow.
And I have, let's just say, some close family members that will go unnamed that have done toad quite a number of times. And I actually have some people visiting me here that actually run retreats where they do toad ceremonies. So pretty darn high dose. So, but I myself have not done it. I've done DMT by ayahuasca, extremely high dose. Mm. So I have a sense of that. I've only done it one time. That was, it wasn't really to my liking, I'll just say. Anyway, but yeah, so I have been around a lot of people around this. I've read a lot about it. Yeah, I've got a pretty good sense of the thing and talked to a lot of meditators also who have also done that. So I have that reference point of their descriptions, which tends to be a lot more phenomenologically precise and rich. So I have some of that point of view. But myself, I haven't actually done the 5-MeO. Why do you ask?
My friend James and I were talking to Andres from Qualia Computing. We talked about that site last time, and these guys are, they're very, very interesting, and they are somewhat Buddhist in the sense that they want to eliminate suffering, but they want to do it through technology. And Andres has stated that he thinks 5-MeO DMT might be the most important tool for exploring consciousness that we have.
Yeah, a lot of people say that. I've heard that opinion many times by people who have done it.
Yeah. As far as something that you can administer and have an experience.
Sure.
I'd love to hear your perspective on what parallels might exist between Buddhism and high-level meditation experiences and the 5-MeO DMT experience.
Yeah, so that's complicated. And one of the reasons the person who may give me this stuff is interested, they're interested in my opinion about like how, you know, what's the comparison? How does it compare to high level meditative experiences? What do I think of it? Since I haven't actually done it yet, I'm kind of talking out of my ass, right? So I don't mean to right. be like, you know, I really want to not overstep my level of technical competence.
Yeah.
That's important, right? Because, you know, so I've heard a number of people say that it really they felt like it substantially shifted things. It like deconstructed their own life, their old life, and gave them a new one. That it was one of the most important spiritual tools or whatever that they had done. They felt like they had some breakthrough they had been looking for, you know, after long periods of whatever, and they hadn't found it. And even other more powerful, you know, sorry, even other powerful psychedelics hadn't done for them. So, a dear family member who has done this, I don't know, 8 times or something, probably, is like, that is the one. That's what they say. Like, this is the one that like, yeah, they've done a bunch of ayahuasca. They've done acid. They've done mushrooms. They've done, you know, mescaline, peyote, you know, like, and they're like, yeah, but then toad yeah. as like in its own category. I hear lots of people say that again. So I'm just reporting purely secondhand. I don't have a way to evaluate it yet, 'cause I haven't done it. So I don't want to overstep my competence. Just assume, because I know a lot about meditation, that I know a lot about it.
Okay. I just thought there may have been some phenomenological sort of parallels of descriptions of what people experience that maybe people could also experience in the higher levels of meditation.
Well, I mean, so like, I mean, you know, when people talk, oh, my consciousness exploded. Well, I've talked to 100 people whose consciousness exploded, you know, during the arising and passing away. And they say, I felt like I was catapulted my body out of, into another universe. Well, the arising and passing away can do that, like on Goenka retreats and stuff, you know, I felt like all of a sudden, you know, but I could see all my energy channels and like the, you know, the energy blasting out into the universe or whatever. Well, the rising and passing away can do that. So I go, okay. You know, maybe. And again, because I haven't done it, I don't know. So okay. Like a lot of the descriptions can sound very similar to me to lots of other stuff that I've heard other people describe and things I myself have experienced. I've had my consciousness explode and my body vaporize into particles and realign into fractal patterns and do all kinds of crazy stuff like that. And they're like, well, yeah, that's this thing. Okay, cool. Valuable experiences, if they're like the valuable experiences I had. But again, I haven't done it, so I got to be careful here. I don't want to overstep. I can compare, just because two people said, you know, consciousness exploded, well, is it always this? I don't know, you know, so.
Yeah, no, fair enough. Speaking of energies and energies exploding out of different channels and these sorts of things, one of the areas that I've sort of been hesitant to explore for a long time are chakras. And that's off because they're often considered woo-woo. And I try my best to straddle the line between woo-woo and rationalism and find all the interesting things that are sort of in the middle and not fall off too far onto one side or the other. So chakras are, they're often at the butt of jokes against spiritual people or the spiritual path. And
why?
It's just like you see them in memes, like there'll be some meme of some like really high dude with dreads and he's at some festival and he's like, I can feel my chakras, and he's doing something silly and people think it's funny.
Got it.
It's just like a kind of stereotypical thing. But I've heard them mentioned by enough people I respect now, and I've personally felt the sort of the centers, if you will, when I've focused on them in practice myself. So I'd love to hear your thoughts on chakras, just generally, like what they are and whether they are woo-woo or not.
So the chakras are an interesting bit of theory and spiritual technology and conceptual frameworks that initially for a lot of people start out as an intellectual thing, though some people have the experiences before they find them. It can go either way, right? And they can be, you know, sort of used at the superficial level of, oh, I'll kind of tune into where my heart is and I'll see if I can feel sort of more loving to people, or I'll tune into my genital area and see if I can deal with my sexuality, or I'll tune into my throat and see what I find there about expression at that sort of level. And that can actually be pretty interesting, right? So just tuning into these areas that do have some clear correlation with something about some of these things, right? So sort of where your third eye area is between your eyes. And if you close your eyes, you can see all these colors, or some people can, right? And if you, you know, some people see bright white lights in meditation, oh, my sixth chakra or whatever, you know, like, the, you know, the correlations are not crazy, right? There's some sense behind them. And a lot of these spiritual technologies like this one has, you know, come along a long way because there's something kind of to where these areas correlate to. It's not just nutty. It's, you know, there's something there. And you can use these at sort of a superficial level, just kind of exploring those sort of psychological issues or finding, you know, sort of like body armor or sort of tensions that may have to do with traumas or whatever. That's true. And then you can go deeper. Like some people sort of feel some energetic stuff, some kundalini phenomena or some sort of shaking. And then some of the energetic models are sometimes useful for explaining that. And some people will go deeper. And, you know, the deepest that I myself have been, I was on a retreat. It was probably about day, I don't know, 15 or something. And I was super powered up by this point. I was a very skilled meditator at this point. This was at Bhavana Society in West Virginia with Bhante Gunaratana. And I sat down in the sit, and all of a sudden I could see chakras and feel my chakras. Like you see in the pictures, like there they friggin' were. And I was like, really? Really? And I could feel all these sub channels through my arms and legs and shoulders. And like, I was looking at some sort of brightly fluorescently lit up Chinese, you know, acupuncture meridian thing. And I'm like, seriously? Yeah, seriously. And it's interesting because I could feel these blockages where the energy wasn't moving. And I was like, oh, that's cool. Like, check this out. And I could sort of like unblock them. And as the more I unblocked, the better I felt. And I spent a while doing that. And after about an hour, I was like, God, that was so amazing. Now I can see my chakras, right? And I got up, the sit ended. And I walked outside. It was in December in the snow. It was their Christmas retreat for advanced meditators, 17-day retreat. This in, what was this, 2001. And all of a sudden I was hit by this massive vertigo and face planted in the snow and tried to stand up and everything was spinning. Yeah, but, you know, when I stood up, I felt great. I felt like a Tai Chi master or something. I was even walking differently. But when I went outside, all of a sudden vertigo hit, face planted in the snow, tried to crawl back to my cabin. Everything was spinning, finally made it back to my cootie and lay there on the floor and things were like all spinning and weird for like 15 minutes. And then I kind of felt better and I kind of felt normal. So, and I've talked to some serious Tai Chi masters since then, some people who are way more versed and skilled in the stuff than me. And they're like, oh yeah, that can happen. When you go, particularly some of the first few times you go playing with these things, it's not uncommon to have some weird experiences like that. They're like, that's just typical. I didn't know. Anyway, now I know. But it was years before I ran into the people who knew enough about the energy channels, because that's, you know, the Tai Chi people, like the best ones really feel and see this stuff, right? And so are they something that sometimes some people for moments can get into or sometimes, you know, really learn to see more often? Yeah, they're a thing. But does everybody have them? No. Are they necessary? No. But, you know, in my experience, wow, they're this thing. And sometimes you can experience them. And I've experienced them some since then, but never quite with that level of like drawn out, like I'm looking at them like what you would imagine if Pixar did, you know, chakras and energy channels. That's what it looked like. Well, that's what it was like for me at that sit. I've never had anything quite that good since then. But some, you know, sometimes this chakra, that chakra, this channel, or this movement, or this color, or whatever. Yeah, okay. And then it's gone. So again, I'm more of a tourist than a native, but I know some people who are really kind of natives, and this is actually a living, real thing that they can learn. They've learned to experience, and is an important part of their practice, and can be really transformative. And so, okay, cool, right? But it's not going to be most people, right? That's pretty high level stuff. So, but it is real. So, yeah.
Did you see them in the different colors, like the classical colors that they're depicted as?
No, most of mine were either white, blue, or red, which is way more like the Tibetan-y depictions of them. And I don't know why, but the chakra systems I was familiar with at that point were the classic seven with the rainbow.
Yeah. And I get the impression that you feel they're potentially useful for some people, but not essential.
Yeah. They're really cool experiences when they arise. And I thought, you know, it was a really neat sit. And did some interesting stuff. And I obviously kind of overshot and didn't know what to do with it. And then got this sort of weird chi rebound or whatever and, you know, fell in the snow. And was just, and then, okay, whatever, you know, so. But yeah, it's beginner's thing, right? You make mistakes.
Yeah.
That's how we learn.
Is there anything from your medical perspective that gives you insight into those particular centers? Like I've heard that there is a bunch of neuronal-like cells in the heart, for example, and in the gut. And there's obviously a lot of nerve endings in the genitals. So.
Yes, no question. So it's interesting. I got to dissect a corpse, right? And one of the things you get to see when you dissect the chest cavity is in the mediastinum, which is where the heart is between the lungs. is that there's an amazing amount of dense, white, thick, fibrous tissue. And I asked my anatomy professor, he's like, oh, just cut through that. I was like, well, what is it? He's like, well, it's all these nerves. I was like, well, that's a lot of nervous tissue. What does it do? They're like, we don't know. I'm like, oh, well. And what's interesting is people who have had open heart surgery, often like their partners will say their personalities changed a lot by it, or they were much more mellow, or they like, you know, had this very different sort of quality about them after that. And some people sort of attribute it to have been on cardiac, you know, cardiopulmonary bypass when they're doing that. You know, something about the chemicals in the machine that keeps your, I don't know, there's all these theories, or the electrolyte solution. But I actually think it's because you just cut through a whole lot of their, you know, this important nervous tissue that has something to do with cognitive or emotional processing. That's my theory. I got almost no data on this except a bunch of empirical sort of case reports of people I know who have had cardiac surgery who've reported these things. And I was actually on a cardiothoracic surgery service in my medical training for, I don't know, 6 weeks or something, and got to ask some people about this stuff and have some conversations about this, which I found really interesting. So this is all, that's also a thing. And I don't know of other surgeries that really change personalities in that way. And it's also true, there's a ton of neurons in the gut. And what's up with the third eye, I don't know. But when I do fire casino practice, which is all about visualization, if I look up and kind of cross my eyes, you know, about 5-6 days into the retreat, I do get this incredible blazing, white hot, yellowish, shimmering thing that, you know, it's hard not to call a chakra. We call it the white and gold. This is a sort of technical lingo that we use, but you know, you can call it a nimitta, or I don't know, you can call it a lot of things. But yeah, that is where you see the bright, blinding white light thing and stuff. And, you know, and this powerful sexual releases, you know, that can happen in the arising and passing away, coming up from the genitals. It really does feel like energy rising up the shushumna in some of these powerful kundalini experiences. So yeah, so like, chakras, energy channels, cool. Do I know what they are physiologically? No. Have I experienced them a lot of times in various ways? Yeah. But you know, I admit my ignorance, right? So I would defer to some of the Tai Chi people and some of the people who are way more natives or well-visited tourists than I am for more in-depth on that kind of stuff.
Yeah, we perhaps need to find a sort of parallel to yourself of a Tai Chi master that's also, yeah, you know, a surgeon or something. That can, sure, that could speak a bit more about that. But yeah, I've never heard anyone discussing it in the sort of middle way between the two there. But that's really interesting to me that there is all those sort of nerves in the sort of heart center that no one really knows what the function is.
Yep.
or doesn't seem to be investigating even.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Very interesting. I suppose it's also quite difficult to do studies on, you know, yeah, slicing open people's tissue in their chest to see what happens.
Although it would not be difficult to change, to sort of do emotional intelligence or cognitive questionnaires or something to people who were having open heart surgery for other things where they were going to have a bunch of that cut.
Yeah,
so that would be interesting stuff to do.
Yeah.
If somebody's wanting a master's project or a PhD out there,
yeah, go absolutely. For it. Yeah, definitely.
More research is needed, as we say all the time.
As it always will be. All right. In our last chat, we talked about entities, and they're one of my favorite subjects. But you said that you're more interested in if the entities are causal rather than objectively real, whatever that means. Have you yourself had any causal interactions or significantly causal interactions with such entities? And if so, would you mind sharing one or two of those?
Yeah. Where to begin? I've had a bunch. So everyone, just the simple fact that I can describe it to you is obviously causal. You know, the fact that the memories are arising now is causal, right? This led to that. So they have some causality to them. So the first interaction with an entity that I actually think of as the beginning, to most people, is just going to seem like a dream. But to me, it has some quality that seems more entity-ish than that. So it's the first time I crossed the arising and passing away that I'm certain of, when I was a teenager. And that entity in this dream was a witch riding on a horse who zapped me with her wand, and this white light blasted out of her wand and my body exploded all over the place. This is, if you listen to my podcast, I've told the story a lot, but I actually think of that as like that witch entity thing was like my introduction to the spiritual path. And so somehow that I guess you could call dream character or fantasy or whatever, stands out in my mind as a causal interaction with something that seemed very other, very intelligent, very purposeful, and to whom or to which, whatever, I'm very, to which, get it? I'm very grateful. That's nice. And so sort of a categorical difference in the way I relate to that character, which was, you know, from a dream point of view, just a bunch of colors and movements and stuff. So other interactions? Yeah, a lot. I mean, I don't know where I've seen a lot of entities along the way, sometimes with eyes open, sometimes with eyes closed, various degrees of transparency, various degrees of physicality, various degrees of interactivity. Sometimes they say stuff, sometimes they don't, sometimes it's obvious why they're there, sometimes they just show up and there's no explanation and you never get anything. And it's like, yeah, there's an entity, but it's kind of like going to the mall, you know, like, why was that person there? Why was that person there? What are they doing? You know, what are they? Most of them don't talk to you. They don't have a purpose. They're just hanging out. And it's like, you know, that's true with most things. And then sometimes you have these interactions that seem very purposeful, very intense, very personal, and have a lot of meaning. So, for example, I had a dream on this fire casino retreat I did at the Tower of Halbar in Scotland some years ago with two friends, and we were doing fire casino. And I had a very, very powerful dream of this red-haired fire goddess who seemed to be the goddess embodiment of the element of fire. And then later on, I can't remember, a day or two or something later, I'm sitting there on the cushion and all of a sudden she shows up sort of like as a disembodied head way off to my, maybe 15 feet to my right, which is kind of through the wall at that point, but somehow like I'm suddenly in this other space and she screams at me, "Become a king of fire!" You know, I don't know what that means, but it seemed very important at the time, you know? Yeah. And if you go to the tarot then, like, oh, well, you're king of fire, and you can read about the tarot card of the king of fire, it's like, well, that's an interesting direction. Maybe I need more of that quality. And so it had some meaning for me and some sort of a semi-actionable direction to it. And so anyway, interesting, but a lot of that stuff gets very, very weird. And then trying to explain its benefit or like, why is that important? Or is that a good idea? Or are you just crazy? Well, those are all perfectly reasonable questions that I don't think have particularly good answers. Mm. So these things happen. The vast majority of entity experience I've had have happened rather than me calling up anything. I very rarely call up entities. I'm just not particularly interested most of the time. So interesting, but again, kind of weird. And most of these things end up being very personal. And when you talk with other people about them, it's hard. You know, it's kind of like people who talk about their drug experiences to other people. It doesn't convey the import of the thing, no matter what you say about it. Does that make sense? Or like,
you
could describe losing your virginity to someone else, but it's not going to, your description is going to be lacking in comparison to the experience, whatever that experience was, you know.
Especially if the other person hasn't had a similar experience.
Sure, particularly.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so there's a couple of things there. So one of those was, I'm kind of interested in perhaps one that would be open-eyed and non-transparent at all. And you say they're causal and they're talking to you, but whether or not you could distinguish them from somebody else that would be, you know, in consensus reality, real, if you know what I mean.
Yeah. So, yes, can distinguish them from consensus reality, real, because they look really different. I've never had an
as if they're like fire gods. Yeah.
Yeah, like that looked like a normal person. I've never had that ever. Some people do. I just haven't. They've all looked weird in some way. They were too tall, or they were naked with flaming hair, or they, you know, had the head of a bird, or they were wearing some incredibly weird clothing that looked like something you'd see in a Thai painting, you know, from centuries ago or something, or like they've all been bizarre, or they're 300 feet tall and stomping along and they look like a giant mountain troll or something. Like, you know, like, so I've never had one that looks normal. So I don't know. It's out of my experience.
Right. Okay. Then I guess the question is, if you saw one of these and they weren't transparent, say they were sitting on a bed or something, you know, some like ordinary object, you know, would you see the, you know, covers of the bed being sort of pressed down in your perspective as if someone's sitting on there with weight, or would they sort of just appear in the environment without actually interacting with what we might call the physical world?
So my experience with these things is that by the time you're seeing non-transparent, fully realistic entities, all bets are off about the rest of reality as well.
Okay.
Right. They seem to interact with it in ways that make some kind of sense now in the space in which you're seeing things. The correlation between that space and what someone else might see, God knows. I have no idea. I have no reference points for that. I've never been in a place where I was simultaneously interacting with an entity and there was someone else there that, had I had the sense of mind to ask them, hey, are you seeing this too? And is the bed depressed like you see? I don't know. And so, but when I've seen these things, they've always, when by the time they become fully fleshed out, they're interacting with the reality I'm now in the way a fully fleshed out thing would interact with it generally, though there are some weird exceptions, like they can just disappear in a puff of smoke or they can fly.
Yeah.
You get the idea.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, I guess this comes back to the sort of point about consensus reality. So the, you know, there's this idea of sort of personal reality, like our brains, as far as we know, are some sort of generational machines that kind of create some sort of world simulation, and that's our experience. And you can talk about reality in a bunch of different terms, but consensus reality is a kind of useful one if you want to stay alive and not get hit by a car or something. Yes. And that's the one in which, like, you know, in society, everybody sort of sees similar things. Like if we're at a supermarket and there's a bunch of cars, and, you know, people are probably not going to hit that car or run into that car because everybody sees it the same way. So that's, that car would be real in consensus reality. So yeah, I'm always going to be looking for that sort of smoking gun that these things have any kind of causal power across many people in consensus reality. That's going to be the thing that makes, you know, that's always going to be a fun thing to try and find. But I haven't found it so far, which to me suggests that these things are probably more inhabited in the personal realities of people more so than the consensus reality. Even if they're causal on that person to change their behavior, the fact that generally people don't seem to perceive these things all at once seems to suggest that they're more of a personal thing. But I'd love to hear your thoughts.
Although if you look particularly within the Catholic literature, there are quite a number of seemingly strangely reliable reports of perfectly sane or seemingly sane people with no experience with anything like this having mass sightings of, like, the Virgin Mary, for example. There are a lot of these, and some of them are recent and modern enough, contemporary enough, that they become very, very hard to dismiss. And those are clearly causal because I'm still talking to you about them now. But I have, so again, my experience is a little bit limited in that I've had no entity interactions that involve someone else, like, you know, humans there with me. But I have had non-entity magical interactions that involve two people seeing the same thing. So my favorite example, if you listen to me in podcasts, you probably heard me say this, but this is the first one I ever had, and it made the biggest impression. It's happened to me about four times since on these same kind of retreats, but I'm just going to tell the story. So I'm on this, I mentioned the Tower of Halbar retreat, which was specifically a retreat to test out joint magic. That's why we did it. And we were all staring at the same candle, getting our visualization capacity very strong. We're doing some magical ritual. We were, you know, this is what we were trying to do. And I had started working with the color amber. So we had not been working with this color. You know, we had been working with red and blue and purple, and I start working with amber, which is sort of a different color and not on the standard list. And we were all had decided to go into town. So the three of us, and we're all weird as, you know, we're very weird by this point, high as kites, kind of, you know, it'd be sort of like, you know, if you were hanging out with a bunch of people on like 40 mics or something, you know what I mean? Like, you know, sort of it's a microdose, but it's enough of a microdose that you're going to notice you're kind of different. Mm-hmm. And, at this point we decided it's going to take the three of us to go into town and get groceries, cause we're pretty bizarre at this point. And we're waiting for the taxi to come, and it's a gray Scottish late afternoon in February, and I'm drawing, you know, I've been doing a lot of these. So I'm drawing a pentagram in the air with my finger, and I'm drawing the circle, and I finish it up. And one of the guys who's on the retreat was like, hey, you just drew an amberish pentagram in the air. and that he could see I drew a pentagram was not surprising to me, but that he knew I had drawn an amber one, which was true, and I hadn't told anybody I was working with. I was like, it didn't strike me as weird at the time because we're all like nuts, kind of semi-nuts a little bit, you know, but in a good way. But later I was like, wait a second, he knew what color that was. Where at the time, it's like, of course he knows what color this is. It's glowing there in space, right? You know, like, duh. But later I was like, wait a second. Huh, he knew. And that's happened to me a few times since then, where I've had verifiable things where I'm seeing things of a certain color and I can, you know, someone else is there interacting with this energy ball or this pentagram or whatever. And they go, oh, okay, yeah. And they can see it and feel it and know what color it is and other stuff. So this is a thing that can actually be done. I don't know what it means ontologically. I have no idea what's the mechanism, how in the world where this happens. I have no clue. I don't know. But if you get your concentration and visualization abilities strong enough and play around with this stuff long enough, this is likely to happen to you. So if you're interested in doing the experiment and trying to come to your own conclusions, which I wish you the best of luck with, this is a doable thing. So
yeah, that's an interesting one. And I just do wonder if it's the sort of collective beliefs of populations that would allow them to be open to experiencing these kind of things collectively or not.
And the chicken and egg of it is complicated, isn't it?
Yeah, for sure. All right. Next thing I have on the list is death and reincarnation, as many people associate Buddhism with the idea of reincarnation, whether they have an accurate idea of what is meant by that or not, and then different realms. So I'm wondering what your take is on death and reincarnation or rebirth.
So there's lots of different ways to approach that. And the way I approach it generally depends on the person I'm talking with and what their goals are and what my goals are for the interaction. So as plenty of my colleagues who are perhaps listening to this will rapidly point out, teachings of rebirth can be unbelievably problematic in the wrong hands, right? They can lead to a lot of condemnation, you know, oh, you got this, blah, you know, it was their karma, they did some bad thing or this good thing, whatever. Like that, those discussions can be get unbelievably weird and ugly and very strange very rapidly and used to rationalize all kinds of stuff. So that's warning number one. Warning number two is in some traditions where having past life experiences or becoming reborn as something is a major focus, that can become the focus of one's practice rather than skillful living here and now in this life, in this body. That is a major problem in certain spiritual circles. And so that is warning number two. Warning number three is if you actually have some of these experiences, it is very easy to get captivated, fascinated by them, confused by them, obsessed with them, react in strange ways to them, you know, experiences of past lives or whatever. And that is another danger and problem. So just putting that out there, it's sort of next level problems. And there are probably more warnings I could give and I forgot to give them. Fine, sorry. Okay. But that said, they can also be very valuable. So for example, I was on a retreat and all of a sudden, I was very, very powered up at this point. I was a very skilled practitioner. I was very powered up. It was deep into the retreat. My concentration is crazy strong. I've had a number of other pretty weird experiences. And all of a sudden these six bubbles about maybe 2 feet wide or something, like kind of beach balls, sort of appear off my, sort of behind me, off my left shoulder, trailing behind me in six previous lives, sort of connected by this sort of grayish cord or whatever. And then they disappeared. The whole experience couldn't have been half a second or something. And in that flash, I got this powerful download of something about each of the lives, something about their personalities, something about how they died generally, what they were like. And it's the psychological benefits of that just kept on coming. It was profound. It felt like it explained so many things like, oh yes, of course, this is why I'm like this. This is why I'm like that. And it gave me insights into aspects of my personality that I hadn't had before that experience that I found psychologically helpful for day-to-day living, for making sense of things, for dealing with various emotional patterns or likes or various things. Anyway, it was very useful. So actually
felt I got great benefit from this momentary experience that some people would say is crazy or delusional, but functionally it A, didn't cause impairment, and I think B, caused some substantial psychological improvements. And actually, then later, many years later on retreat, it was pretty recently, last few years, I had another past life experience of a life, you know, I don't know, 1,000 lifetimes in the past or something, that it was actually one of the more powerful psychological transformations of my consciousness in a relative sense I've ever had. And it gave me this tremendous sense of sort of faith in whatever is going on in some kind of way that's hard to explain. I could talk more about it. But the point is that for me, at least, I have found my relatively few experiences with past lives to actually be quite positive and transformative. That said, there are certainly not necessary. They can really confuse people when they happen. And so regardless of any questions of ontology, does this truly mean I existed in past lives or stuff like that, which can become incredibly problematic, the experiences caused some practical psychological benefit. So I'm willing to say that. In terms of the deeper end of issues of rebirth, you come to the core ontological problem of the sense of a continuous identity. Very straightforwardly, one can verify an experience. There is no continuous identity. There is no self that is maintained moment to moment. This is the heart of insight. This is the core teaching of the Buddha. This is the punchline of the deepest wisdom practices. And so from that very ultimate, very wisdom-oriented point of view, teachings of rebirth are nonsense. They're transient, empty sensations that arise and vanish depending on conditions. There is no past. There is no future. The current moment does not withstand scrutiny. And so all we have is empty causal processes that arise and vanish. And that is all we can truly verify and know. And so from another band of dealing with this stuff, rebirth is nonsense because there was never a self to be reborn in the first place. And that is a deep transformative wisdom that is also a very useful thing to come to some understanding of. And vastly more valuable, I would say, from my point of view, than the psychological benefits, while very real and impressive, that came from having past lives.
I've got a few notes here just on that. Firstly, let's go back to this powerful experience that you briefly described just before.
Yeah, okay. This is going to sound pretty darn weird. So here we go. All right.
<okay. laughs>
Woo-woo city now at this point. All right. Why not? What the heck, you know? Let's go. So I'm on retreat. It's a solo retreat, and it's 17 days, and it's towards the very end of it. So I'm sitting there in just like late morning or something, maybe early afternoon, I don't know. And I'd been sitting for a while, and all of a sudden I get into this very powerful reverie. And in this reverie, almost like a very powerful daydream would be kind of a way, or a momentary, very trippy, transportive experience where I feel like I'm now getting information and experiencing reality in a way that was suddenly very, very altered from normal way of perceiving things. And in this, I get this information, if you will, for better or for worse, veracity, whatever, ontology, whatever, that maybe, let's just say, 1,000 lifetimes in the past, which I think is sort of a placeholder for a lot, I was some kind of unbelievably powerful karmic wizard god thing. And this karma wizard god thing seems like it spent what to me would be an incomprehensibly large amount of time sending these sort of tendrils of exploration out into the vast web of causality, both forward and back, to see all the cosmic and karmic forces that were coming to bear on this life and all the possible options for the future, and having sort of in its massively powerful karma time computing brain or something, it was able to figure out the optimal pathway of all the pathways to go down in terms of causality and rebirths and situations and decisions and everything, because it could see in this extremely unusual way that pathway. It then, and I get the sense this is highly translated to make sense to a being of vastly inferior capacity to try to make sense of what the hell this thing was and what the heck it did. Yeah. The I think really like kindergarten stupid impression I have is that it took this sort of giant golden ball essence of itself and tossed it with, hurled it with like Herculean cosmic force down one causal channel. Basically saying, that's the best pathway. That's where we're going to go. And we're going to like cast that spell and send causality or the consciousness hurtling down that. And by doing this, it's not that necessarily everything would be good. There's going to be death, destruction, carnage, crazy mistakes, all kinds of bad stuff. But of all the possible options, this was the best of all possible pathways. And at this point, I sound like Pangloss in Candide. I don't know if you've read Candide or if the readership has. But like, this is the best of all possible worlds, where weirdly enough, as cynical as the book is about that philosophy, given how much bad stuff happens to Candide and Pangloss, I weirdly enough now have the deep psychological notion that whatever happens to me, waiting in traffic, stubbing my toe, is the best possible thing that could be happening at that moment, and that the other options were all worse.
Yeah. Well, that's right.
That doesn't mean what's happening is good, but like, whoosh, dodge some other bullet. This is better.
Yeah.
Now, to have that kick in again and again throughout the day, now years, it's been a few years now, like this just keeps happening. This is now like a baseline level of faith that all of this bad stuff, whatever it is like a bullet dodged. Thank you. There's this sense of faith, gratitude, like appreciation. And however crazy that sounds, the experience of it is ridiculously helpful. Ridiculously helpful. And it doesn't change my decision-making. I still am like trying to make things good and trying to figure things out and avoid pain and go towards pleasure and, you know, the usual stuff that people do, right? But yet when things go badly, which, you know, they do in life, or they're just boring, like I'm just sitting in traffic. I'm like, wow, thank God I'm sitting in this traffic, and whatever that other thing was that the giant karmic wizard thing, you know, got me to avoid, thank God for this. And this is automatic. This is not like cognitive. It's just like this feeling that wells up again and again and again throughout my day, every single day. That is friggin' awesome. That is like gold. And this was totally off the radar of anything I've seen described, anything I knew to ask for. I don't even know how to do this. But the weird thing that was the second part of the download in this reverie was that not only did this happen to me, this has happened to everybody. Because if we have countless previous lives before us, of course all other beings at one point were, you know, karma god wizard things that could do this. And of course they did this. And so however fucked up their life is now, it's not a rationalization, you know, that, oh, it's okay that their life is fucked up. No, but it could have been vastly more fucked up had that not occurred. So even as bad as things are, there should still be some level of gratitude, which again, people like, you know, it's easy to then take that and say, oh, what about this terrible thing that happened to these people? That was really, yeah, okay. So not helpful to really just do that. But somehow I get the sense, okay, everybody's taken care of in some weird way. I still work all day to try to make things better, you know, myself and people, you know, help and be beneficial. But that was all part of this force, right? That was part of the toss of the essence or whatever down the channel. That's just how it goes. Cool. So there's this at the psychological level rather than some other level, there's this tremendous sense of appreciation and gratitude. And I am extremely grateful for that insight. Wow. Like what a huge game changer. Tremendous.
Reminded me of, have you ever seen lightning when it's in slow motion and been captured at a very fast frame rate? And it's all these sort of tendrils come down, and then once it hits a certain point, then the lightning just goes down and smashes it. Highly recommend anyone that hasn't watched slow motion lightning to do that, because it's great. Yeah. But that just images sort of reminded me of that. So it's quite interesting. I wonder if as an animal, like humans, our sort of abstract rationalization sort of sections of our brain and our software that we've developed over the last very short amount of time is quite new. And I wonder if this sort of mythological, you know, story type framework is actually what the rest of us needs in order to feel reassured or feel feel faith for something and feel that something's real.
Well, that's widely reported. I mean, like, look at the major, you know, godfather, you know, father god based religions, like all the you know, Abrahamic religions. I mean, that's their thing, right? And there are people who gain tremendous benefit from the sense that there's a plan and their life is taken care of. And that's clearly extraordinarily psychologically popular and helpful for some people. No question.
Yeah, for sure. And but the point is, like, if someone had just told you that story or told you that that was how it was with you.
Yeah, no.
It wouldn't have had any effect.
Probably, I would have laughed at them.
Yeah. That was ridiculous. Yeah. You would have thought it was a good story, but you wouldn't have, but since you experienced it in this quite visceral manner, and it was significant to you, it's sort of, do you feel like it may have had significance to what we call the lower levels, and not in a sort of better or worse sense, but just lower levels of your animal psyche that require that in order to feel safe and well?
Definitely.
Yeah.
No question.
So this is the interesting thing about what you've been saying about causality and entities and all this, what some people would consider woo-woo experience. And you obviously don't care anywhere near as much about the phenomenology as you care about the outcome and how it's causal, right?
Well, I care about the phenomenology to the degree that allows me to have good outcomes.
Sure. But the good outcomes are obviously that's the important part of it, right? Like,
yes.
There's all of these different sort of mimetic subcultures, and some of them are quite powerful and large, and some of them are very small, and some of them exist online, and some of them exist only, you know, in forests and small tribes or whatever. And I imagine they all have different kind of belief and myth frameworks that are in place that will insulate them from certain ideas and allow other ideas in, and vice versa. And some of them are quite strangulating. Like, it seems like the hard materialist nihilistic view is, some of those people are pretty chill and happy, but a lot of them seem to fall into like depression traps quite easily.
Yeah.
Compared to even some people who people would consider a bit loopy and a bit like too new agey and a bit out there, but they seem happier. And though they may not have the wisdom to go about their life a lot better than they could be, they may be just generally happier than someone that's in their other state. So
yeah, like, so for example, my mom is a classic example. She did her PhD in biophysics at Yale on scholarships, and then was, you know, then something happened to her, let's just say, and she went off in a totally different new agey direction from her very scientific materialist in some way of being in the world, where she was doing, you know, working in a lab all day, you know, at Yale. And she is a very happy person, though if you talk to her for a while about her beliefs and her experiences, it would be hard not to come to the conclusion that she was pretty darn far out there on the fringe of the new age. And yet, to be around her, she is extremely happy, if sometimes some people think a bit weird, but, you know, sometimes a delightful weird. So yeah, and very positive. Much more positive than a lot of, yeah, my scientific materialist existential friends, right? So existentialism, the tyranny of the logical reductionist cutting mind, you know, we think of these people as not being particularly happy for a reason, you know, Sapcha and, you know, et cetera, not that happy, right? Yeah, pretty tortured. Definitely true.
Yeah. So what I'm interested in is finding something in between, which I find that you're a perfect example of, actually, is that you have the hard materialist side of you in medicine, and that you have to conform to, obviously, and that is very important for consensus reality and acting well and not harming others when you're looking after them.
Yeah, the biological and biochemical and physical, you know, chemistry, all that's very, very useful for solving and dealing with certain problems. Although if that was the only model you use when interacting with patients, people would probably not like you much as a clinician.
Yeah, very robotic. So it's interesting that there's probably a whole bunch, well, there are a whole different amount of sort of frameworks you can apply to people's sort of spirituality. And some of them, depending on where they're at, will resonate with them and allow them to find meaning, whereas others will completely turn them off. Like, I know I'm going to put an intro to this conversation, but if I just dove into this conversation a few years ago, right in the middle when you were talking about, you know, some of the more magical stuff and all of that, I would have just completely switched off, and I wouldn't have been able to have this conversation with you now, because that was just sort of the framework that I was in.
Yeah, understandable. And the same would have been true for me. So, like, you know, me at 18 listening to this conversation, I would have been like, really? No, because this guy's nuts, right? So that would have been my impression absolutely as well. True. And I get that. That's fine. And maybe that's the the way of looking at the world that they need then. Maybe that's good for them. Maybe that's important. Maybe, you know, something is beneficial about that. I don't know. So maybe.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
So the morality training in Buddhism that we talked about last time, and the idea that of this never-ending project to act better in the world and be a better person and have better interactions and try to cause as least harm as possible and all these sorts of things, which is, as you say, is never-ending. This is where it kind of intersects with all of this stuff, right? So I've been sort of playing around with this idea for a wee while, and I'd love your opinion on it, but this is the idea of sort of mimetic insulation from mental illness or from becoming a person that harms others or themselves. So do you have much insight into how much of mental illness is reliant on belief structures or on unbalanced belief structures that go too far into the woo or too far into the material side? And how much of it is just simply uncontrollable biochemistry? So like nearly anyone could be mentally ill if you give them the right amount of drugs, and that's purely just chemical. But on the other hand, too much magical thinking without some basis in consensus reality could fall into some serious traps as well.
Or not enough.
Yeah, yeah. yeah.
Right, so, not enough magical thinking to satisfy whatever part of our brains needs magical thinking.
Yeah, or yeah, exactly.
To, you know, uncover the sort of archetypal mythic way that some parts of our brains think, and thus converting those into shadow sides. So relating skillfully to both the rational and the magical sides of our self is actually something I just did a very big podcast on with the Imperfect Buddha podcast. So if you want to, I actually had a whole discussion kind of about that sort of thing, but I can repeat a little bit of that material. So I use a framework that I originally got from Ken Wilber, actually, in his original book, The Spectrum of Consciousness. And I think of it not developmentally, but in terms of all these different bands of our experience. And some of our bands are very magical, and some are very rational, and some are very unitive, and, you know, so, and integrative and whatever. And we have all these sides of ourselves. We have, as the advertisers know, and as the story writers know, and the myth makers know, we think very mythically, and our hearts and our guts and our, we resonate very much with mythos, with story, with image and archetype, and these are very, very powerful to human experience. Even people who think of themselves as very rational, right? And yet the intellectual side brings us tremendous benefit, you know, with the amount of cool things you can do with equations and math and engineering and cell phones and whatever, cars and stuff, you know, amazing in their ways, also destructive in some ways. And, you know, so each of these bands of our experience, I think, can be developed, but that learning how they can interact with each other and play together well, I think, is a key part of spirituality, and learning to honor all these parts of ourselves and not turn any of them into shadow sides or lean too heavily on any of them. So I kind of dodged your question, but going back to your core question about causality of mental illness and how much disbelief versus pure biochemistry or genetics impact that, I don't know. There's endless speculation that they're related, right? So, and you can look at lots of different schools of, you know, is it birth trauma that causes this? Is this our upbringing? Is this neglect in childhood? Is this the cultural and society that we are in? Is this, you know, is all mental illness purely culturally conditioned? Or is it all pure neurochemistry or biochemistry and just its genetics and its, you know, dopamine regulatory whatever problems or something? You know, we just don't know all that. I don't have the data on that. We don't know yet. We haven't unpacked all that. I could talk out of my ass or whatever and yeah, speculate. But I've also run into plenty of people, as we all have, I'm sure, that you look at their belief structure and you go, well, that's fucked. Right? That's not working. Like, dude, why are you thinking that? That's not helping you. And other people who you look at their belief structure and they're like, wow, that is really working for them. You know? And so clearly belief structures are part of it. No question. And some cultures seem to have certain tendencies to produce certain aspects of better outcomes. That doesn't mean there may not be a trade-off, right? Some highly technological, rational culture might suck at something else or whatever. You know, so who knows? But you get the idea.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, the intuition that I had for that was actually my own experience with particularly being very stoned, which there's some types of weed that you smoke and they kind of just put heavy existential dread and horrible paranoia and all these sorts of things, which, you know, in hindsight can be quite useful.
Probably need more CBD.
Yeah, definitely. Unfortunately, it's still illegal here in New Zealand. So we,
You know,
we're waiting for it to become legal so we can kind of choose what we want. But they're interesting in this, in the sense that I can feel all of these sort of quite compelling feelings of angst and paranoia, and also weird sort of belief threads that are trying to go places that are just, I know I can always fall back on my grounding and what I've sort of learned myself about philosophy and what I consider reality and what I consider to be important and real and true. And I can always fall back on those, and it always allows me to go, okay, I'm not going to follow that one all the way out, and I'm not going to let despair take me, even no matter what. Like, I can see it there and I can see the path opening up, but I'm just going to quietly decline that and just sort of come back. And I don't know if that is due to what I've learned and what I've sort of ingrained within myself and what others have taught me, or whether that's some weird, you know, genetic thing that I've just been a born optimist, you know, ever since I was younger. But it certainly feels like that has a big impact on me. And that's the reason I was asking the question.
Well, it's basically CBT, right? So cognitive behavioral therapy is clearly effective and clearly useful. The ability to recognize mind states and our emotions and where pathways are going, and evaluate whether or not they're helpful in that moment and rechannel them to something else. I mean, yeah, heck yeah. I mean, obviously, right? That's just from a certain point of view, just common sense. And that kind of technology is mentioned in spiritual tradition after spiritual tradition. And, you know, it's core Buddhist technology as well, right? So if you look at like the Sutra of the Removal of Distracting Thoughts, for example, it's basically CBT. And so these are old notions and obvious sort of common sense notions, and definitely an extremely good idea and one of the more useful relative bits of tech we can adopt and train in and practice, definitely.
Nice.
And, you know, the brain is neuroplastic till we die. And so you can always rewrite channels, and you can rewrite pathways, and you can rewrite beliefs even. You can rewrite habits of mind. You can rewrite emotional pathways and responses. And what the limits of that are, I don't know, but definitely doable. And all of us have noticed something about that, where we figure out how to get over something or see something in a different way or go through some process. And now we have more, you know, calm or balance or something. The stages of grief, Elizabeth Kubler-Rossian, very useful technology and true. And properly grieving and then coming to acceptance, that kind of thing can change the way we emotionally and behaviorally and cognitively relate to, you know, unfortunate situations. And this is clearly something changing in the wiring of our brains. And yeah, so definitely all good stuff.
Last thing on societal stuff and societal sort of belief structures, and that is, I'm quite fascinated by the idea that there's a large segment of the population in the West who are silent experiences of endogenous altered states, or arising and passing away events, or kundalini experiences, or whatever you want to call them. And a bit like preference falsification in the Soviet Union, they cannot talk about them in public because they'll be considered loony, especially if they're more conservative types. And so hence they perpetuate a culture which denies that these experiences exist completely, or just puts them down to mental illness, rather than figuring out a way to take them seriously and integrate them into the culture in a sort of wholesome way. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, it's funny you mention it. So actually, one of my big projects at the moment began when I retired from emergency medicine, and then I was doing some stuff, and I ended up starting to do some research projects and start some research and network with some researchers who are also all practitioners. And so they've had their own powerful spiritual experiences, arising and passing away things, and equanimity, and some paths, and jhanas, and some powers occasionally, and stuff. And by the way, they like all have doctoral degrees, and most of these people are hanging out at like Cambridge and Harvard and Yale and Brown and other major top tier universities, right? So these are people who have pinnacles of education, are at the institutions that in theory are the cutting edge of truth and revelation of what is true and possible in science and all these things, right? That's, you know, you can't get more high in the ivory tower than these things, which in theory are dedicated to the open and free exploration of the truth wherever it goes and describing that. And yet basically none of these people can talk about any of that They would never talk about it. They won't mention it. They're afraid they won't get tenure. They won't get grants. They'll be ridiculed by their colleagues. They're afraid to study this stuff. They wouldn't tell their, you know, their friends at work ever discuss this. Like, just huge no-no. And what's wild is at this point, you know, they can say they're gay, or they can, you know, or lesbian. They can say, you know, they've done psychedelics, that they, you know, participated in some, you know, mushroom research trial at Hopkins, or they've even, you know, worked on something like that. They can say all of that. You know, they could even say they were Republicans, for Christ's sake, you know, but they can't, sorry, that was just wrong, you know, but they can say all of those things, which is fine and wonderful and great, which, you know, things that used to be taboos, and now you can say them, you know, in an academic setting, and it's cool, that's progress, but they can't talk about their deepest spiritual experiences, which for most of them are like the things that truly defined them, changed them, and the most valuable thing they've ever had happen to them. And so there's still this very, very powerful taboo, even at literally the highest levels of what, you know, the organizations and institutions that think of themselves, oh, we're so open-minded, we're dedicated to the truth. No, they fucking aren't, right? And they're just, no, like, it's just total bullshit. And so actually my dream at the moment is to figure out how to kind of go around a lot of those institutions and the sort of funding blocks and stuff, and figure out how to get funding for some of the research projects that they and I dream of, and we dream of collectively, that would actually explore some of these deep states and transformations and capabilities and stuff. And I'm actually going to be doing a study with one of those researchers who's not going to say anything to their department about their experiences, but they will, you know, help me do some fMRI and EEG stuff with some states and stuff. And that should be fun. And so there's some proto-science that can be done, but in terms of these people being allowed to actually speak their deepest truths, no, they can't. And so we're there, even at the highest levels of learning. And so this is actually a very hot topic for me. And like every week I'm having discussions with these people about aspects of this stuff. So that's actually a big part of what's going on in my life at the moment, is figuring out how to break that taboo and sort of align myself with other people who are interested in breaking similar taboos, and networking together to gain enough strength and coordination of messaging and stuff to figure out, okay, how do we actually overthrow that bit of real heavily shadow side irrationality of even these high institutions? Okay, thank you.
It seems like a lot of it's to do with language, right? Because a lot of the language that's used to describe these experiences, you kind of don't have any other language available to use, and that language is conflated with the 60s hippie movement and the very far out New Age movement.
Weirdly enough, when I was at Cambridge actually recognizing this, I started talking with anthropologists and linguists. So I actually got a top tier medical linguist, like at the pinnacle of his career, a genius, super nice guy, looked like an old British army colonel with a mustache and everything. It's really amazing. And was talking to him about this exact languaging problem. Like, how do you language this in a way that is not alienating, that simultaneously, I mean, there's a lot the linguistics has to do, because you want to be able to reference the cool tech and the previous discoveries of the mystics and contemplatives who got this done better than anybody, right? They've got the most advanced tech and maps and conceptual frameworks of this stuff. Not that they're all perfect. They're not. But they're better than anything academia has by far, like, 2,500 years advanced on the, on academia. But how do you reference all of that stuff, which actually does have some replicable value, and that you can do the empirical experiment for yourself and see, oh, I can do this. This is doable. This is attainable. This is something that can work. And, you know, maybe not the descriptions are always sometimes a little flowery, but whatever. So how do you reference all that stuff without running into the exact problem you just stated, where you use a word that then just triggers all this, images of, people, they don't like and don't think very well of, and then become disrespectful of anybody who would use that word, and have all these unfortunate and distorted connotations that came out of popular culture's digestion of, old spiritual traditions. And so we actually spent hours in conversation thinking about that problem and how do you come up with language for that. And that will actually be an ongoing conversation, and it will take a lot more people working on that problem to figure it out. And how do you get, how do you get these things into the DSM and ICD-11 codes, right? This is the medical and psychiatric billing codes. How do you do that? Because that needs to happen. Until that happens, The other thing I'm dealing with a lot of is, I have friend after friend, person after person, they contact me and they've had some powerful spiritual opening or experience and they ended up on meds or inpatient psych or wrecking their life or whatever. And the medical establishment, while able to provide some chemical stabilization, was utterly unable to provide reasonable normalization, reasonable trip sitting, reasonable conceptual frameworks, referrals for other people to help them process these experiences, you know, ways to take advantage of the opportunities that these traditional spiritual experiences presented. And as we have more and more people being taught traditional meditation techniques, we're going to have more and more people actually getting into traditional meditation effects, right? Because the original techniques were not designed to make you feel better in your cubicle. The original techniques were designed to blow your consciousness to pieces, to have you, you know, have powers, have these wild altered states of consciousness, you know, and, you know, dissolve into God or recognize Nibbana or whatever. And like, you know, people are not prepared for that. They don't have the frameworks for this. They don't have the conceptual understanding. And the medical establishment is like at a kindergarten level when it comes to actually helping people with this stuff, and basically like, oh, here's some antipsychotic, that's what we got. Okay. Yeah. I mean, and sometimes very helpful. Okay. Like helps calm them down and they survive a few days, right? And they, you know, they're not as spiritually unstable anymore or whatever. Okay, fine. Some of that's valuable and some lives are saved by doing that. Cool. But the rest of it is unbelievably primitive. And that's what I hope to actually do enough research and science and coordinate some research teams to start undoing some of that problem and the conditioning that prevents us from having, let's just say, a more skillful and reasonable relationship to powerful spiritual openings and transient altered states of consciousness that, while sometimes initially very troubling or confusing, are generally real opportunities for powerful transformation that can be very beneficial and eventually quite amazing and helpful.
I'm really happy that you're leading the charge on that.
Yeah, except it's going to take a lot of people and a lot of time, and our chances of failure is very, very high. So when I look at all the really smart, awesome people who tried this before, like Christina and Stanislav Grof, like, you know, most people haven't heard of them, and yet, you know, check out their spiritual emergency network, you know, the Stormy Search for the Self, or that kind of stuff, like amazing, like linguistically problematic, sort of tied to Freudian stuff in a way that seems very outdated. Okay, fine. But like most of the good tech is in there. Like they got a lot of the stuff right and then people don't know about them and it never entered the mainstream. And you can go back before to Abraham Maslow, who most people think of as being the guy who came up with Maslow's hierarchy of human needs. Actually, his big gig was studying peak experiences. Peak spiritual experiences, but nobody even remembers him for that. It's lost. Like, unless you're a dedicated academic psychonaut and you know a little bit about some of that stuff, otherwise, like, no, you're not going to know any of that. And so the vast majority of these incredibly smart, very talented people, some of them major universities, like, they failed, right? And so I assume my chances of, you know, and me and my friends who have the same advantages as they did, our chance of failure is also incredibly high. But we, you know, tilt with this crazy windmill anyway, and hopefully we'll make some progress.
They're high, but you're also in the sort of era of psychedelic renaissance and Burning Man and things like this. So,
and creeping fascism and, you know, blah, blah, blah. So there are forces moving in multiple directions that are very powerful. We'll see how all of it goes.
Sure. On that topic, I'm curious in your thought on the widespread sort of notion of meditation apps, because I remember last time we talked about this, you said you wouldn't actually recommend meditation to anybody because it's the same as recommending drugs to somebody. Like, you have to know a lot about them and they have to know that they have the right supports in place, because things can go quite wrong if your consciousness explodes and you don't have the framework to deal with it. So that was my next question, and you sort of segued into there anyway, but it's quite obvious that you feel there's a need to figure out how to help people that will be having these crises. One of the bigger pit traps are the other spiritual communities that are less balanced on the rational side and materialist side. As I said, I find you very well in the middle, which is fantastic, but a lot of the others aren't so grounded in consensus reality and materialism. And that's perhaps one of the dangers, is that they could also try and jump on board or take up the mantle and just cause a lot of not very useful discussions, or just kind of derail the whole thing. Have you thought about how to insulate against that?
There's no way to insulate against that. So that kind of stuff is going to happen, right? So there's going to be, at this point, there's so many voices in the meditation space and so many apps and so many programs and so many courses and so many retreats. Like, it's a cacophony, right? There's no, like, you can't filter that noise. There's going to be the noise. There are going to be so many people researching so many different things through so many different frameworks and paradigms and levels of understanding and traditions they're coming from and shadow size and strengths. Like, it's a mess at this point. And in some ways, a beautiful mess. Like, it's amazing we even have this mess, but it's pretty messy, like, and there a lot of efforts are not well coordinated. I think we need a lot more sort of meetings between traditions and various groups that are working on various projects and attempting this. Actually, some sort of, when I really get like hypomanic and grandiose, I think, okay, we need to figure out a way to coordinate all, you know, like B. Alan Wallace's group and the TM kids from back in the day and, you know, whoever else, you know, they're like all these disparate things. And there's a whole bunch of these sort of Hindu groups that are kind of trying to fuse science and meditation together. And, you know, a lot of them do an okay job. So there's a lot of stuff out there. And like, and also the sort of digital corporate world, which is now mindfulness, is this huge thing, right? And they're doing it their own Silicon Valley influenced way, right? And then there's the whole fusing it with the self-help improvement, get your highest tech executive maximum function thing, you know, which is going on. Like, you know, there are all these strains, right? And it's changing all the time, right? And there's new ones popping up all the time and old ones dying off. So it's sort of the Wild West out there from a kind of a point of view, but amazing. Like, and yet, dude, holy shit. What, like, you know, so that's my impression, right?
Yeah,
at the moment.
Yeah. Well, Godspeed to you.
To all of us. Thanks.
Yeah. All right. I want to get into some big philosophy now. Firstly, time. Have your experiences given you any particular insight into the nature of time? Because there's a couple of camps. There's presentism, the idea that the only thing that exists is the present and the past does not exist and the future does not yet exist. And then there's eternalism, which could also kind of be synonymous with the block universe theory, which sort of posits that time, as Andre's put it, much like France is a place over there that exists still while I'm here in New Zealand. The past is also something that exists over there, and the future is something that exists over there. And there isn't really causality, and the whole thing's just one big thing. Somehow we're surfing along it. Have you had any particular insights into the nature of time on the mat?
Yeah, but that's going to relate back to, I am at my heart an ontologically agnostic empirical pragmatist. Ontologically agnostic meaning I don't think you can truly say which of those things is true. I actually don't know how you would do the experiment that would show one versus the other, because each of those major theories has their explanation for how certain things happen. And I don't know how you prove it's one versus the other. Maybe there will be experiments that we can figure out that, you know, definitively show that, but I would be astounded. Curiously enough, all of those experiments are actually based on empiricism. And empiricism, in one way, is experiment. In another way, is actually our immediate experience. In our immediate experience, thoughts of time come and go. They always occur now. You can notice that the experience of any thought of present or past occurs now, and then is gone. We cannot find a past in our experience, though memories that seem to relate to it in some way that we can take to be a true past or a true future arise now. That we can know in our experience. And in this, I'm very David Humean, if that makes sense to the philosophers in the crowd, the great British empiricist, or I guess Scottish, really, I think Scottish. Anyway, he rightly points out that the first basis of all of our extrapolations of those kinds of theories is our experience, but they're all extrapolations that arise and vanish now. In experience, it is very useful experientially to notice that thoughts of past and future arise and vanish now. So experientially, I wouldn't even say there's a stable present that exists, because the present is utterly unstable, right? So not only is the past gone and the future not arisen, but the current moment does not withstand scrutiny. I'll stand with the Tibetans very nicely on this, because they're experientially right. And the rest is all extrapolation. So I then get to pragmatism. So we've gotten to ontologically agnostic empirical pragmatist. And I'm a pragmatist because each of those frames may be useful for certain problems or questions. And so I adopt my frameworks based on their ability to demonstrate utility. And if they can demonstrate a utility for a certain problem that is better than one of the other frameworks, then okay, use the best framework that you've got for whatever problem you have, if you can distinguish that one is better than the other. But to hold any of those ontologies that are extrapolated from empiricism, but probably unprovable, as far as I can tell, I think that's just unhelpful. And so, you know, but if someone really gets off on fixating on one and saying, no, this has got to be the true one. Okay, well, if that's your kink, whatever, enjoy. But I'm really not sure how that necessarily helps beyond someone's fetishism or whatever. So that's my take on it. Did that help?
Yes. Yeah. The more I'm looking into this, the more it seems like we have to adopt different frameworks for different problems. Utility, as you
say. Yeah, we do that all the time, right? So we are constantly doing that. We don't think about our relationships the same way we think about our bank accounts, hopefully. I would hope.
Yeah. And then, as you say, if you take the non-dual monist view, the whole thing just becomes a circle of paradoxes anyway.
Intellectually, the conceptual mind leads to that anyway. It always leads to paradoxes like Gödel's incompleteness theorem and Heisenberg and whatever. Anyway, so that's just what it does. The arbitrary nature of the sign, that's its nature. So whenever you make a Laruelian decision and slice the real or reality in some sort of arbitrarily conceptual way, you create a problem. Well, hopefully you sliced reality to actually solve a problem. But most of the time when philosophers slice reality, we then actually create one. But empirically, there's actually just immediate transient experience arising and vanishing. And there's something actually nicely satisfying about that. Not that the level of philosophy can't be helpful too.
Yeah. I think I know the answer, but I'll ask anyway. Is consciousness fundamental, or is matter or space or emptiness fundamental?
Again, so I'm going to go back to ontological. So when you say fundamental, you mean ontologically the true basis of reality. So I'm going to go back and we're going to do this again, which is going to be fun. So I'm an ontological agnostic empirical pragmatist. What that means in this case is consciousness eternal? Well, I observed consciousness very clearly and found it to be impermanent. So consciousness arises and vanishes numerous times. It has disappeared, reappeared. I've seen that thousands of times, and it goes away and then poof, it comes back. And same with everything else in my experience. So things are clearly impermanent from an experiential, meaning human, empirical point of view. Everything else is extrapolated from that. So if you want to extrapolate permanence based on an experience of impermanence, okay. If that helps you to do something to solve some problem, okay, great. If it helps you when computing your trajectory of your rocket to assume space is permanent and or whatever. Okay, fine. That's fine. Cool. If that works for you, great. And so again, I'm pragmatist. It really depends on the problem I'm trying to solve. But from an experiential point of view, everything is utterly transient, including consciousness, including space. These can experientially be verified through meditative practice to be experienced to arise and vanish. There's something profound about that I found transformative and helpful, regardless of any true ontological implications. But it seemed to be an upgrade to my mind when I was able to perceive those things clearly, that functionally feels better, which is a way more rubber meets the road kind of way of looking at those kinds of questions than most of the ways people look at them.
Sure, sure. What is it that's experiencing consciousness disappearing if that thing that it's experiencing consciousness disappearing isn't consciousness itself?
Yeah, except so consciousness can disappear and then it reappears. And if it's truly gone, there is no experience. It's literally like frames were edited out of a movie.
Yeah, okay, that's where I'm getting at.
So you're sitting there, reality disappears. At some point of time later, reality reappears, but there was no sense of time or a perceiver or anything in the middle. There was just frames edited out. What could one say about that? It's like if you're deep in meditation and let's say a car is sort of driving by your open window and it gets halfway and then you disappear in meditation and then you reappear. And you don't hear the second half of the car that's now at your window driving away from your window. You heard it driving towards. Consciousness disappeared. When your consciousness restarts, the car is gone. There was no perception of time, space, consciousness, or anything. But you know that at least empirically, experientially, consciousness vanished and reappeared because the car is not there anymore. Whereas you should have heard it driving away from your window, as opposed, you know, the whole thing. Do you see? So there are these ways, these tools and tricks that we can use to identify these gaps in consciousness, even if we weren't there for them because they were a gap in consciousness. Does that make sense?
Yeah. It's like deep sleep, right? Like you only ever experience falling into sleep or waking up from sleep. And actually the only thing you ever experience is being conscious, right?
Correct. And by definition.
Yeah. And so that kind of gets to the core of the question of if that's true, if the only thing that we do experience is consciousness, is that the ontological, eternal, never changing fundamental thing that everything else is built around and is a projection from?
Say that again.
Have you heard of Donald Hoffman?
Give me a context. Names out of context are sometimes confusing to me.
Sure. He's just sort of burst onto the scene. He's a computational scientist from Irvine, and he's causing a lot of waves because he came up with this provocative piece called The Case Against Reality, which is actually a bit misleading in the title. But he posits this idea that reality is fundamentally just basically eternal consciousness, and that all of material and all of matter are projections in the same way that an icon on your desktop, on your computer, points to something more fundamental. All the matter and everything the material is a pointer towards something more fundamental. Yeah.
I watched about six minutes of a video by this guy. Okay.
Yeah.
So his point that he was making, and again, I don't know his work well, so I just know 6 minutes of a video that I think was much longer than that, right?
Yeah.
And his point was that clearly this is all like sort of a holodeck of interpretation. And that's obviously true from one point of view, right? And we also have plenty of empirical in the scientific sense and experiential evidence that our representations of the world may be functional, but are not often designed to be that accurate. They may have survival benefit, as he points out very skillfully, but they may have also been highly filtered and tweaked for that goal rather than anything to do with accuracy. Yeah, there's a lot of evidence for those kinds of points. But when it goes back to an eternal consciousness, no, I don't think so, certainly not experientially. Now, how one would posit an eternal consciousness based on a consciousness that is clearly perceived to be impermanent, I do not know. And maybe he has some sort of magic there, but I don't know what that magic is.
As you say, it's quite well established that everything we perceive is some kind of world simulation that we build, and it's not actually representative of what's, you know, what could be considered objectively there, which are a bunch of waves and particles and molecules or whatever. That part's quite clear, right? But then the step further that he takes is like the materialist scientists would say, yes, but still eternal space and matter are the things that were there that emerged somehow from the Big Bang, and then consciousness emerged from that and then created these world simulations.
Well, all those things are extrapolated from an empirical experience that is utterly transient and where consciousness disappears and reappears, as anybody who's gone to sleep knows. And so that's at the level, as again, the David Hume would very rightly and I think unassailably point out, all extrapolated, maybe highly predictive, maybe useful for solving certain problems, but to give it ontological supremacy is obviously fuck not crazy. Sorry.
Yeah, and actually, go for it.
Dr. Hoffman is listening. Apologize, I just called you fuck nut crazy. That was probably not very nice.
No.
But anyway,
he would admit himself that he is also he's putting this theory up to be falsified. Like he's not claiming anything. He's also agnostic, but he just wants to put forward a framework.
Delightful. Oh, and maybe it's useful for something.
Yeah. Rather than the theory of everything from physics point of view, which can't really take into account quantum mechanics and all of the wacky shit that happens down there, but from Newtonian and the way up is very useful. He wants to posit, you know, kind of flipping the model and saying that, you know, what happens if we take consciousness as the fundamental model and then build everything from that? Grant me one miracle that is that consciousness is the eternal big thing, and I'll build you a theory of everything. Much like material science says, grant me this one miracle of there being matter in the first place and a big bang, and I'll build you a theory of everything. So I quite like his approach.
Yeah, I would say, again, I'm more an empiricist than a eternal consciousness-ist.
Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah, I don't know. I still don't know where I sit there. I guess I want to believe that there is an eternal that it is just simply eternal consciousness.
We have a great drive for immortality and for stability. People cling to that, even very advanced spiritual practitioners. So I think like half the Mahayana suttist got stuck there in a stable all ground of being. Yet, yeah. As anybody who's managed to get stuck there for a while, like I was, and then go farther on the spiritual path, sorry, I'm going to piss off a lot of people now. Like, you can then see, you know, the fundamental ground of being, space, consciousness, all those truly arise, vanish, not be a refuge, and get really good at noticing that, to the point that the illusion that these things that seem so stable and nice at certain levels of realization are in fact not stable, and are in fact, as the Buddha so wisely said, are in fact utterly transient.
Okay, I'm still going to continue to delve into the monism world in my own time and examine that. And I will take those points into account. Even with the empiricist view as the ground of what you extrapolate everything else from, I still find it hard simply because the only thing that we do experience is being conscious. There's still something I'm grappling with there, but I don't think I'm going to be able to tackle it today, if ever.
Yeah, yeah. I think it's a fascinating thing to grapple with. And that grappling process, I think, is very important. So grapple away, man.
Thanks, man. Cool. I think I know the answer to this one as well, considering the last the last question. But I'll ask anyway, and you'll probably laugh. Is there such thing as universal morality? And does it even make sense to consider it? Yeah, there you go. Perfect.
Wow, yeah.
I'm asking it because so many people love this question, and I thought it would be funny to ask you it. I know the answer, but I just thought I'd ask you anyway because it's fun. Go for it.
Yeah, it's delightfully fun. Okay, so is there a universal morality? I don't mean to be a touch cynical. If you track back morality and notions of sort of high-minded intrinsic or universal morality, if you go far enough back, I will claim you always come to some variant of the person articulating the theory's self-interest. And I don't mean to be needlessly cynical, but I think that's true. It's not that explorations of morality can't be extremely useful. It's not that moral codes can't have tremendous functional value. It's not that lots and lots of societies and cultures and individuals haven't over the years come to a lot of pretty similar conclusions about things to include in moral codes and the reasoning behind why one might do those things or not do those things or have those laws or strictures or taboos or whatever. That said, the number of exceptions to this functionally, theoretically, and practically are obviously as we know them, as the news daily shows us, as all our best aspirations and New Year's resolutions and whatever clearly demonstrate day after day at a thousand small and large and grand and societal and planetary levels, our capacity, despite thousands of years of moral thought, our capacity to follow those injunctions is obviously freakishly limited, and the power of our primal lizard minds to influence our decisions about a thousand things, from whom we bomb today to what we buy and its global destruction or whatever, you know, on and on. We constantly are making moral decisions that exist in very murky shades of gray with negative consequences, most of us not having any concept of the full implications of our actions and no way to even get that information. So the whole basis of our moral judgments, which in theory has something to do with good outcomes and causality most of the time, is unbelievably flawed. And what a mess. Like, so it's interesting to talk about, you know, from sort of a high abstract platonic universal of a universal morality. But it, practically, like, dude, that is so far up into the ivory tower that it's really hilariously laughable.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah,
not that it isn't sure. fun to try. Right.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
We all stagger along trying as best we can. Good luck with that.
Yeah, yeah. No, I thought that would be fun, but to bring it back. Yeah, that's perfect. That's perfect. To bring it back down to some more attempts at like practicality, especially techno-charged practicality in the future, is like the goal of Buddhism is to eliminate suffering in all sentient beings, right? Or all beings.
Well, no, that's sort of one way of articulating certain aspects of the Bodhisattva ideal.
Okay, yeah. Relating it to morality, that would be quite a fundamental principle, right? So,
well, it's also relating to wisdom. If you're talking about eliminating suffering, that's also incredibly complicated because technically that involves literally all beings becoming fully awakened and then all dying. Right, that's just what that means. Just so we're putting this in some kind of realistic perspective, that's what that means. Go on.
It reminds me of a character that I invented. I made a weird text-based adventure game as an art piece at this party that we had, and you find yourself on this ship with all these weird diseased aliens that are really horny that want to talk to you, and you don't know where you are, and your job is to like figure out what's going on. And then you end up there's like a prison cell underneath, and there's this like weird gray alien in there, and you talk to him, and he's been imprisoned because he believes that it is his moral imperative to eliminate all life in the universe because then it won't be able to suffer. And so,
yeah,
it reminds me of that character in some ways. So it's like, you know, let's not create a fundamentalist narrow AI that just decides to eliminate all suffering because it might come to the same conclusion.
Is that like a Will Smith movie with the grand computer that decides that the only reasonable, rational thing to do is eliminate all humans because they're destroying the environment and the planet or something? Isn't that that's already a sci-fi? That's multiple plots of various things, but
yeah. I'm not sure if any of them. It's probably been done, but this particular character wanted to eliminate all life in the universe.
Oh wow!
Yeah, but he was a nice guy, and you'd have a nice chat to him. Yeah. Are you familiar with the article that Nature published in 2013 on the mouse study, which pretty strongly seems to show that mice inherit the fears of their fathers epigenetically for at least two generations?
Yeah, I've heard a number of epigenetic studies of stuff like that, and also some stress-induced stuff like in mothers, like related to their babies and,
yeah,
you know, environmental stressors in humans as well, right? And it may be metabolic syndrome stuff from stressors and things and anxiety that goes on years later. Yeah. So yeah. Epigenetics is clearly a thing, right?
Yeah, there's like multi-generational sort of epigenetic trauma, which...
Yeah, and you see that in people who have undergone like abuse and, you know, had really bad childhoods and stuff. Like, yeah, they continue to have complicated problems metabolically and stuff sometimes. Yeah, there's something real there.
Yeah. I've spent quite a bit of time in Germany, and there's a lot of waves in the older generations from the war that are still affecting even people my age. I'm 27. I'm curious how do you guys deal with these kind of traumas in practice, and especially trauma that's quite buried or perhaps not even directly experienced by the person, or they're not completely aware of it, but it's definitely affecting them in some way?
From a certain point of view, anybody who spends enough time meditating, stuff's going to come up, right? And from a sort of cognitive point of view, hopefully, if the stuff comes up and you spend enough time with it, you come to equanimity, and then now it's arising in a more equanimous mind, in theory, sometimes you can get the amygdala to now recognize it doesn't have to be on hyperstimulated overdrive whenever this particular thought or scenario or whatever arises, and it can kind of reset itself. That definitely happens sometimes, right? And plenty of people who have done meditation retreats notice this. And, you know, the various traditions frame it in different ways. Like, so Goenka talks about it in terms of sankharas, and some of the other Theravadan strains talk about it like, you know, karmic releases or, you know, traumatic releases or, you know, you know, and then the sort of modern trauma people like, you know, the body keeps a score and, you know, trauma sensitive mindfulness, which are some interesting books to read on this. They have their own kind of way of talking about this and how you can bring things up into different spaces and gently feel into them and sort of recondition your amygdala, which then seems to behave differently. And is that epigenetic? Like, is memory partly genetic? How are memories stored? We don't really know. And how does that affect then your offspring? We don't really know. The science is very much in its infancy, right? But it would, if those traumas can have effects, you'd think that resolving the traumas could also have effects. I'm not sure. I guess it's a guess, right? We have almost no data on that kind of stuff. But I'll tell you a weird and interesting story from my own practice. So I think I've told this one on another podcast. I can't remember, probably, but I had just stopped working in the emergency department. And this is, what, March 29th or something of 2 years ago. And I finished at like midnight and was home by like one something in the morning. And the next day I was on a plane to France. And a few days later, I started an intensive retreat. And what was interesting is working in an ER, you get to see a lot of unbelievably bad stuff. The kind of stuff that can, like, people seeing it once might have you 5 years of therapy. And I'd seen hundreds and hundreds of maybe thousands of super bad things, right? Very intense and very intense situations. Sometimes when myself physically exhausted, sometimes one after the other. And that takes a toll. And that, you know, sort of can engender a sort of a lots of little micro traumas, which, you know, for most people would have actually been major traumas. And you get this cumulative effect. And no matter how resilient you are, or how good your practice is, like this mammal is designed to remember these things that are drilled into it with high degrees of adrenaline. A lot of these encode situations, you know, were very intense. And when you have a ton of adrenaline and cortisol and a bad experience, you can form some very strong, vivid memories. That's just how our animal has this survival mechanism. And so I had a lot of these very strong, vivid memories. And I started having, it was like my brain, literally as soon as I quit that next night, I started having these incredibly powerful nightmares. And these I'm used to nightmares. I've had nightmares all my life, and I've actually got quite a tolerance for some very bad dreams. Most of them don't affect me that much in a way that I think they would affect a lot of people. At least I've heard them describe, you know, dreams similar to mine having a powerful effect on them. And they didn't, but these dreams were kind of like next level. And it was dream after dream, like maybe five or six a night. And I'd wake up sweating, you know, and like, it was like, you know, I'll sort of give you one of them. Imagine like I'm in the ER and there's 15 people laying on stretchers with their guts hanging out, screaming in agony, bleeding all over the place as the room is filling up with blood and I can't find any medications. There's no nurses and the power's out and the blood's slowly filling up the room and I'm going to drown in the screaming blood of all these people, you know, like that kind of dream. So it's pretty intense, horrible stuff. And this goes on for a week. And then, so I'm about probably 70 hours or something into my fire casino practice at this point. My concentration's getting stronger and stronger and stronger. Actually, some of these images were coming more and more vivid. And I sat down this one morning before breakfast, and breakfast was like 10 minutes late. So I thought, oh, I'll just sit for 10 minutes. And I just sat down, and I sat down in this incredibly blissful space, just profoundly blissful, stable, like rock solid, amazing bliss. And it just showed up. I didn't have to do anything for it to show up. And so it's one of these things where like, how do you cultivate that? I don't know. I just did a retreat and this thing showed up. So that's not very helpful from a like, how do you replicate this point of view, right? I don't know. And my suddenly I could see my aura. And I'm, as I said earlier, I'm not that much of a chakra and energetics people. I'm way more of a tourist, occasional tourist. But at the moment I'm seeing my aura and it's like this bright electric blue, like a bar magnet coming out of my head and looping down around, and space is white and sparkly. And this bliss is like rock solid stable. And I sit there for 5 minutes and it's just delightful. And there is my electric blue aura and there's sparkly white space. And there's this unbelievable bliss and I'm hanging out. And then one of these really bad traumatic thoughts comes up. Of, you know, something gone horribly, horribly wrong in this person's life. And I got to be there and witness this thing. And it came up as a little phone icon sort of down in my lower abdomen. And it flipped over a few times and it disappeared. And when it disappeared, I suddenly felt like this weight, like lift off my shoulders, like it had reset something about that trauma. So for the next 5 minutes, I brought up trauma after trauma and they all showed up like little phone icons and they flipped over and they disappeared. And then I would feel this release. And after I got done with all my bad ER memories, the bliss was still stable. Space was still sparkly white. Aura is still blue and electric or whatever. And I'm like, well, that was kind of amazing. Let's see if we can do the rest of it. So I start bringing up all these other fucked up things from my life, you know, divorce stuff and, you know, childhood traumas and stuff that happened on the playground and stuff with my parents and, you know, broken bones and surgeries and car accidents and all this traumatic stuff. And one by one, it's just turning into phone icons and disappearing. And when I finally stood up 5 minutes later, I had run out of bad memories. I was like, that's all the bad stuff in my life I can possibly think of. And I felt so light. I felt like 1,000 tons of weight had like lifted off of my shoulders. And I had that sort of weird shakiness. Like if you ever swum a mile or two, like I swum a really long distance. Well, when you get out of the pool, you can have this sort of shakiness. My muscles felt like that. And my face and sort of my chest and stomach felt like I had been crying for hours, but I hadn't been. And my mouth feel, there's almost like a taste when you've been crying. And I had that, like I had been, but I hadn't. I'd just been sitting for 10 minutes. And the dream stopped. And I felt like vastly lighter and psychologically freer since then. Now, it's an extreme example. I have no idea how the fuck to replicate this. I don't have a clue. Like, I don't know what to tell you to do, but I do know this happened to me. So if it happened to me, it can happen to other people, and maybe a lesser degree or other variants. I don't know, but it just got my concentration really strong. I got into a blissful space. I started bringing up traumatic memories in a very different state. And somehow that seemed to reset my amygdala or whatever. I'm, you know, just talking about my knowledge of theory. I can't feel my amygdala or anything. But, you know, and I've felt vastly better about those things since then. And it's like, that was really freeing. And so the theory that meditation and deep blissful states and concentration and revisiting issues in a really different space can reset trauma is experientially true for me. And I'm not the first person to have noticed that. Again, this is a little bit more of an extreme example. I don't know why I got blessed with this thing. It was super cool, but very needed, because I needed to process a lot of that stuff that I really hadn't had time to process working in the ER. Right? Because you're just running from patient to patient to patient to patient and then collapsing at the end of the day. There's no time to really feel it, you know, or work through it or something. It just kind of built up. So thank you, meditation. That was awesome. I don't know what else to say except unbelievable gratitude that these things can occur.
It's interesting that you brought up the fact that you entered this sort of blissful state before you brought up these memories, because that reminds me of the parallels and the recent MDMA, PTSD sort of things.
Yeah, absolutely. I can definitely see how that could reset something. Yeah. I was actually just at MAPS. So I was visiting them in Santa Cruz at the end of October, and super nice people. Wow. And doing exciting work. And I actually went to the Breaking Convention. I guess it's just called Breaking Convention. But in London this summer, and it was very remarkable, and some great people doing some very well done research and some other fascinating discussions by non-researchers and practitioners. It was just a really interesting time and very encouraging. And again, like so many positive things in the world, I'm just waiting for, you know, some toxic fascist assholes to shut this stuff down. But for the moment, it's nice that it's going in a really seemingly positive direction. There will be, you know, problems like with anything, but still, I think there is a lot that's positive that will come out of that.
Yeah. Yeah, MAPS are great. Another question on as far as these sort of parallels go is, and the sort of darker area is, when I was reading your descriptions of the dark night and the rising and passing away loops that people can get into, it sounds quite similar to what people experience with bipolar. Do you think there's some overlap between those two?
Oh yeah. So this has been noted again and again and again, right? It's so obvious. You can't help but see the parallels. In fact, there's a whole YouTube channel is Bipolar Awakening, right? And he's talking about the fact that these cycles, right? And he's not the first to have noticed them, right? So all of us who are in this business and who have been practicing long enough or seen what happens on day 6 through 10 of most, a lot of Goenka retreats for a lot of people or whatever, right? There is spiritual highs, you know, amazing. You're not sleeping. You're all ecstatic or whatever. And then you crash. And this has happened to me, you know, countless times, and my friends countless times. And I have also some friends who have true bipolar disorder, right? The real deal. Like if they don't take their lithium or whatever, they end up, you know, 6 weeks not sleeping, talking at a million miles a minute in an inpatient psych institution. So like the real full-on thing. And you know, the parallels are clear. And is it very likely that one is just sort of a pathological version of the same spiritual machinery, just with some subtle biochemical or, you know, causal variants? Yeah, I think so. Probably. Right. I think these things, I mean, there's so many parallels. Like there's no way, if we have duplicate machinery that does the exact same thing in our brain, just one's the spiritual variant and one's the pathological variant, you know, which is not always entirely easy to sort out which is which, you know, all the time, except the long-term trajectory of the spiritual stuff as the cycles get less and less and less and easier to integrate and lead to positive outcomes, whereas pathological bipolar, they get more and more strong as you get older, particularly without meds, and the more manic episodes you have, the more damaging it is, and the outcomes tend to be bad if you don't stabilize, right? So different, you almost distinguish them by their trajectories than by their, you know, the symptomatology a lot of times along the way, though there are some perceptual things that differentiate some of the spiritual experiences. But some of the, you know, people with what I'll think of as more traditional bipolar disorder also can have some heavy spiritual and powers and perceptual overlay. So like, do I think these things are very, very highly related, and it's probably only a few subtle biochemical and or structural and or causal differences that make it go down one pathway versus the other? Yeah, probably, but I don't have enough data on that. Although now that we've got some really good fMRI tech, we may be able to study some of the stuff and get people, you know, hopefully if we can catch them on retreat in the arising and passing away and or the dark night and compare them, if you can get manic people into a in a scanner to lay still or whatever, like to study them and say, hey, what brain centers are activating? What are deactivating? What are the underlying pathways? What's the connectivity? What are the similarities? What are the differences? And I think that's doable right now. We have the tech to do that, and someone needs to do that study or figure out a way to fund my friends to do that study. So if you happen to be a funder who's listening to this and you want to fund some top tier researchers to do some super cool research, hey, please contact me and I will get you in touch with these people who are, you know, I'm not asking for money for myself, but I would ask for money for my friends who I think are going to move these important fields forward. And if you want to talk to me and I can connect you with the people who can actually do that research, that would be awesome. So thank you. That's an advertisement. All right.
Yes. Thanks. Do it.
Yeah. Thanks, please. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. If you're like a tech bazillionaire or something and you're like, wow, I've got like a whole bunch of money lying around that I otherwise wouldn't be able to spend responsibly. No, sorry. That was critical. If I have a whole bunch of money lying around that I think could do some real good in the world and you find any of these research ideas I've talked about interesting, yeah, truly, please. Like one of the things I'm working on these days is building the networks of researchers, but also of the funders that have deep enough pockets, because this stuff is not cheap, right? It thousands and thousands of dollars per person you study. It's weirdly pricey to do research these days, and the universities take their cut, and the imaging technology is expensive. MRI is $1,000 an hour. The transport, the time to get through IRBs, funding people's salaries, like this stuff costs big money. And so figuring out how to move the field forward is tricky when a lot of this is stuff people don't want to fund. Right? Mm-hmm. Mental illness doesn't get a lot of funding. And then when you add in woo-woo spirituality maps, like, yeah, how's that going to go? Right. Yeah. So one day, maybe, you know, the NIH or whatever will be wise enough to recognize the benefit of some of the stuff. But at the moment, I don't think they're quite there. And if they are, I apologize for underestimating them. So.
Yeah, I imagine some of them are and a lot of them aren't.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a bunch of the crypto bourgeoisie have done some interesting work with that. Vitalik from Ethereum, I think he donated quite a lot of money to MAPS. And there are
very exciting. Go Vitalik.
Yeah. Yeah, he did it a wee while ago. And
nice.
Tim Ferriss, who's a famous tech guy, he's recently put a lot of money into psychedelic assisted therapy research.
Awesome.
I think with Johns Hopkins. So yeah, there's Wonderful. A bit of that going on, and hopefully there'll be more. So if there's anyone listening, again,
Yeah, I have a whole team of top tier scientists that are at some of the best universities in the world who we have all these research dreams of cool projects we want to do that we think not only are theoretically interesting, but will really help people practically. And yet, you know, again, the funding for that's a real trick. So yeah, let me know.
All right. A couple more darker topics, and then we can get back into some, maybe get into some metta and loving kindness to finish off.
That sounds good.
Yes. So psychopathy and sociopathy have been really fascinating to me for a long time, and also obviously terrifying. I'm wondering if you've had much experience interacting with these kind of people, and if there's anything that practice and your insights have to say about those kind of people.
So the topic is incredibly complicated and somewhat sensitive. So I should mention that I've worked for a number of people who were true narcissistic psychopaths, high functioning, that were my bosses. Some of them have done amazing things in addition to the messed up things they did. So And they're very complicated, right? So a substantial portion of CEOs of major corporations and stuff are probably narcissistic psychopaths to some moderate to large degree. I have a friend who I one day said to them, hey, what's it like to have no empathy or guilt or a normal conscience? And they said, who would want any of those things? Like, I'm free from that pain. Why would you want to hurt because someone else hurts? Like, how does that make any sense? Like, I'm free to move, like, in this world in a way that other people aren't. I'm a wolf among sheep. Like, they just thought it was the craziest thing that you would want to have empathy or a normal conscience or guilt. Like, they just, like, why? You know, and I was like, wow, that's powerful and interesting and honest and totally frightening. And yet, wow. You know, yeah. So like, and there's some fascinating books on the topic, right? You know, you can read about these things and surgeons, right? I've known a reasonable number of surgeons who were true narcissistic psychopaths. They're like, you know, they have no ordinary human emotions or feeling or connection with people in any normal way. And yet were technically unbelievably skilled because none of that got in their way. They're not thinking about how the patient's feeling. They're just doing their technical craft, you know, to satisfy their own, whatever their own motivations are. And I've had a lot of benefit from having my patients operated on by some of these moderately scary yet unbelievably skilled, saved a lot of people surgeons. So that's true, right? Mm. And so like, it's not a straightforward topic in terms of the utility of these sorts of people. It's also clearly true as you watch the news, like daily, these assholes risk blowing the whole friggin' planet up, right? You know, that's really terrifying. And they cause staggering amounts of economic inequality and injustice and torture and damaging things in the world and are constantly risking the planet and all of our survival, right? So that's really frightening. And yet, you know, some of major accomplished people in history were clearly moderately narcissistically psychopathic. Who did some pretty amazing things, if sometimes kind of ruthless. So there's a survival advantage in some ways to having these people around, but it comes with a pretty high price. And the interesting thing is that the personality disorders, as they relate to awakening, I have a reasonable amount of evidence from people I know extremely well that simply waking up in the grand technical sense and or having a whole lot of training in meditation and or deep jhanic states does not change the fact that you then still have a personality disorder. They seem fixed. Like, you're not going to enhance your empathy when you literally seem to have never had that wiring or mechanism in your brain to begin with, period. And so I know a reasonable number of people who have some seriously deep practice who are also seriously narcissistic and even a few seriously psychopathic. That doesn't mean that they may not be functional and that they might not provide some reasonable amount of benefit in the world. But it's kind of like having a pet tiger. A person who forgot that their pet tiger was a tiger for an instant could end up with a real problem. So the topic is complicated. There's nothing about the personality disorders in Buddhist texts that I've ever seen, except sort of vague inferences that you can kind of maybe hint some of the people the Buddha interacted with that kind of maybe had these things, but it's very vague, right? They weren't conceptualized back then. And I think that is one of the great insights that Western psychology brings to the table in terms of identifying these qualities and saying, hey, this is a pattern and these patterns are problems. But curiously enough, they also seem to be opportunities because some of the most successful people you'll ever meet became outrageously successful, some of whom did great things because they had some of these cluster B traits. And the cluster B personality disorders include narcissism, you know, the antisocial, as it's often called, but sociopath, psychopath, exactly how you split those and differentiate them varies by the person you're talking to. Anyway, but the point is the same. And so from a real world point of view, it's a very complicated topic. Working in an emergency department, up to a third of patients presenting to an emergency department, because they tend to, you know, the people with cluster B personality disorders, there are some associations with higher levels of trauma drug addiction, suicide, risky behavior, etc. Not that all of them have that. Some of them don't. But on average, there are. And so up to a third of people who presented to me each day in my emergency department had a major cluster B personality disorder. And that usually became pretty obvious within a few minutes of interacting with them. Not that some of them couldn't be delightful, interesting, sometimes very charming, very polite, pleasant, cool people in some ways with interesting talents and perspectives and all that stuff are true. And yet, by the way, also a cluster B personality disorder, right? So that's just one aspect of their character and presentation. But again, just recognizing that the prevalence of these is quite wide, and it does explain a lot of what you see going on in society, sometimes good and sometimes not so much, and sometimes really bad and sometimes really amazing, just like bipolar, right? So like the amount of cool creativity and art that people in their manic phases of bipolar disorder has come up with is unbelievable. Like Mahler's Eighth Symphony, like incredible piece of music. And I think he was manic, you know, the whole time he was writing the thing. So yeah, these are mixed.
How would Buddhism perceive taking life as self-defense, or perhaps non-self-defense if the self doesn't exist?
Yeah, so that's kind of funny. Okay, so from a relative point of view, framing things in terms of morality, where you're assuming individuals, you're assuming responsibility, you're assuming that you have choice, right? So as opposed to wisdom trainings that assume emptiness, interdependence, causality, ephemerality, whatever. But the morality training, Sila or Sheila, assumes self, others, causality, responsibility, interactivity, rather than the other. Okay, so just so we're clear on our paradigmatic frameworks. Yeah, so the Buddha was fine with people self-defense and actually would praise good kings that wage just wars and things like that. So the Buddha was, in some ways, you see some elements of sort of almost real politic, and it's hard to know how much of that stuff is actually inserted later by people who are trying to please monarchs, right? So the problem with the Buddhist texts is they were arising in political contexts and often funded by wealthy patrons, princes, kings, etc., who had their own political issues to deal with. And so any tradition that is clearly dependent on those with money and with food and with shelter for their livelihood, it's nearly impossible for them to not have some at least semi-sympathetic or real politic-like or influenced appreciation for those people and their points of view, such as even going to war, and such as, you know, influencing, you know, laws, and such as, you know, capital punishment, and such as whatever. And so you just have to recognize that when we read the Buddhist texts and attempt to figure out what the Buddha said about this stuff, we can't be 100% sure that we're getting a truly clean read that is free from their obligation to the kings and princes, etc., that funded them, sheltered them, gave them sanction, and didn't kill them and or take their resources. So as we find in all religions, that they end up making these complicated sort of ethical and moral compromises with the people that fund them and support them and have the power to dissolve them, right? So if somebody with an army could dissolve the Buddhist sects, as, say, the Mughals did to the Buddhists in India, basically, right? So, like, no more Buddhists in India for a long time after the Mughals ran and just killed them all. Yeah. As one of many possible examples, which gives you an understanding for why the Buddhists were often clearly sensitive and aware of where their bread, on which side their bread was buttered. And so there are some weird kind of texts that you find that you read and you're like, really? That sort of seem to be justifying just wars, justifying wars that spread Buddhism. There's clearly justification of self-defense. Right. It curiously enough doesn't quite have that turn the other cheek element in some ways that like Christianity and Jesus did. Although, on the other hand, if you go to the Jataka birth stories, which are sort of part of the sort of like almost like childhood, you know, mythology and almost like fairy tales of Buddhism, and yet you learn a lot about the culture from seeing what the stories and lessons they're giving, they're putting in their fairy tales. And one of the things that you find the Buddha as a bodhisattva doing was like sacrificing his own life for his cub or whatever. And, you know, so you find some of those as ideals in Buddhism in some of the stories. And then you also find ideals that are like, no, killing for a just Buddhist cause or whatever could be fine. And you, it's a mix, just like the Bible is a mix in the same kind of way, where you find clear justification for righteous war, like that's the Old Testament, you know? And you find turn the other cheek from Jesus. And then even later on, you sort of find some complicated compromises and give to Caesar what is Caesar's. Like, okay, fine, the temporal powers will be what they be and do what they do and own what they own. Okay, whatever, we're going to stay out of that. And so you find both. And so the Buddhist texts are like that as well. So it's hard to get a clear read. Was that helpful?
Yeah, it's sort of cleared up that it's not clear.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, that's cool. I imagine you might be on the side of self-defense.
I personally would defend myself. There's no question. Yeah. I've been attacked by people in the air. I defend myself.
Yeah,
that's just what happens. And even regardless of any ideal, that's just what this animal seems to do.
Yeah, right?
Because when the adrenaline comes up in these, you know, in some intense situations, there, it's not, the rational parts of my brain are very far away, and there's the instinct, and the instinct is what comes up, as plenty of people who have found themselves attacked find. They either freeze, which they didn't expect themselves to do. They may, even people who had training to defend themselves might even be carrying mace or some weapon or whatever. They just freeze like a rabbit. Sometimes that's what the limbic system does. Or sometimes they attack and they never imagined they would attack someone, you know, in this situation, or they do some other weird thing. Like, and they had no idea that side of themselves was there until they felt, you know, found themselves in a situation they hadn't been in before that then unlocked the visibility of that kind of conditioning that they didn't even know they had.
Yeah, I had a couple of those experiences in Europe with some weird situations. But yeah, it's definitely a interesting state to be in. And both times I observed myself doing the things, seemed to be sort of outside of myself, watching myself do these things. It's like, oh, that's weird.
Yeah. And as nearly everybody in war has observed, when people get hungry and pissed off enough, they defend themselves or they attack other people, right?
Yeah,
that's kind of what happens. So, yeah, and that's part of human nature. I mean, there are those individuals who don't, but on average, we do. So regardless of our ideals, like, you know, if you look at the wars that Christians, as one of many possible examples, don't mean to single them out, but like, you know, the ideals of Christianity are pretty clear. And yet the wars based on Christianity are also pretty clear. And so there we have it.
The difference between detachment and aversion is kind of subtle, right? And I'm wondering if you could give a wee bit more insight. The difference between those two things.
Yeah, it's very much actually like the question of indifference versus equanimity.
Yeah,
so exactly. It's basically kind of the same question. And so indifference is considered the near enemy of equanimity. It's sort of deadening imposter. So equanimity is actually accepting of the full range of experience in some clear way, whereas indifference is clearly subtly aversive and shut down and based on some sort of dampening down of emotion rather than opening to the full unfolding of whatever is going on with the emotional reactions in the situation or whatever. And so clearly, just like that, aversion versus indifference or whatever, you know, aversion and indifference are kind of bound up in each other. And so what's the practical aspect of this question? Where did this question come from? Like, is there a way to ground it in something less theoretical and abstract and something a little more real world?
Not really. It's just for some reason at the end of this passage, as I said, some of these things are just a bit random.
All right, cool.
But we can also pass over that because the equanimity thing we did cover a bit in the last conversation. But what I want to get to, which is one of my favorite things, and to get us away from all this violence and self-defense and dark night loops and fears of our fathers and things, which are interesting. But
yeah, why pay attention to suffering, huh?
Yeah.
In Buddhism in particular. Just kidding.
But just to bring it back to a bit of a more wholesome area, I'd love to talk a bit about loving kindness and metta.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. So I've done a bit of metta practice myself and I've felt it in some subtle and some stronger periods, but not in like a really crazy way. But I'm curious, I've heard high-level meditation can feel similar or identical to the peaceful, loving state that many people experience on MDMA. And I'm wondering if this is true, or if perhaps even meditation could even exceed what people might experience in MDMA. And if it's true, how often could one inhabit such a state? Like Jack Kornfield seems to be someone who inhabits that state with quite a lot of regularity, for example.
So to be fair, I've never done MDMA.
Okay.
So I've never done any amphetamine-based anything, any of that family. So I just honestly don't know. So I've got to be really careful about my limits here and not overstep my areas of expertise. That said, I have talked to a whole lot of people who have done MDMA, had a whole lot of friends who have done MDMA, and basically universally they report that the feelings of love feel incredibly real. The feelings of connection feel as incredibly real as when they might be arising in a non-chemically induced situation. And that's what person after person seems to report. So, and sometimes these can be incredibly strong, just like in meditation, they can be incredibly strong. Having not done, having only had the one, so I've had some very, very powerful feelings of love and delightful connection and sense of warm empathy and all that stuff arise from meditation. But I can't compare to the other, so I just don't know.
Okay. No, fair enough.
Yeah.
Well, how about the second part of the question? How often can one inhabit this sort of open-hearted, very peaceful, very blissful state?
Well, all of these experiences are very trainable. So just with repetition and with figuring out how to access them and cultivate them, and with a well-trained mind, one can start dropping into those within seconds as often as one wants, right? Like, you know, right now I can just drop down and start tuning into those qualities. I've done many, many, you know, hundreds, thousands, I don't know how many hours of loving kindness practices and other Brahma-viharas as well. So like I've spent a lot of time figuring out how to get in touch with those feelings. And I can just start dropping in and dropping in. And if I drop too much farther, I'll probably stop talking. So I'm not going to drop that far. But like, you know, there they are, right? So like you can learn. This is a trainable thing. And if you reinforce those pathways enough, suddenly you just have access to that. And within seconds, one can be starting to feel those feelings and develop them up and build them up and tune into them and feel them evolve and grow and expand and eventually get a little cooler and wider, but still blissful, and expand them out and extend them. And that's a learnable thing. And so as often as one wanted, assuming that there wasn't other extreme circumstances keeping you from doing that.
Would you mind sharing any particular practice sort of objects or tips and tricks you have that you find useful for metta? I've tried a few different ones, but it's always nice to hear different perspectives.
So I like this very simple book, Loving Kindness, The Revolutionary Art of Happiness by Sharon Salzberg. It's a cliche thing to say. What you need to add to that book, which it doesn't have, is an appreciation of the jhanas. So, but if you take those as instructions and examples and just good pointers, it's a great book. And then add to it the capacity to take these as jhanic objects. So traditionally, you would, you know, cultivate the first three Brahma Viharas, loving kindness, compassion, and appreciative joy or sympathetic joy or empathetic, whatever you want to call it, mudita. And then you would cultivate these up to the third jhana, which still has that blissful quality, through the rapturous, amazing phase of the second jhana. You know, first you start with effort, and then with the dropping of applied and sustained effort, the blissful, warm, loving, you know, strong aspect really comes online. And then eventually that sort of becomes more mature and kind of cools as you enter the third jhana and gets wider. Now to get to the fourth jhana, you have only upeka, the you know, equanimity, which is the fourth Brahma Vihara, actually can go to the fourth jhana, because the other three still involve some sort of blissful positive feeling, and the fourth jhana is technically neutral, so, and more equanimous. So, but that was what one would do back in the day. And when you take them to that level, it's vastly more reinforcing, and they just go a whole lot deeper. So cultivate these things as feelings and breathe into them, and figuring out how to get jhana off them. For a lot of people, will take retreats. So, you know, go on a retreat with someone who can teach you how to do that. This is just a learnable thing. And as your mind settles down and you find these more and more pleasant and attractive, that sort of Skinnerian conditioning eventually, like the mind's like, oh, wow, loving kindness feels really good. Being neurotic and worrying about my back pain or boss or whatever feels really bad. And the mind will start to gravitate towards the nice ones, right? Which is one of the cool things about these practices. They're very self-reinforcing. And yeah, they may raise some emotional issues and stuff along the way that you have to deal with. Okay, fine. You're delving into those areas of your heart or psyche that may have some things you need to process. Okay, cool. But then once you've kind of cleared out some of that stuff and dealt with it, you know, or come to some better relationship to it or whatever, then like the positive feelings are just so nice. The mind's like, yeah, give me more of that. And once it figures out how to get some, it'll start getting more. It's kind of like the drug phenomena, but the nice way, the skillful way, rather than not so skillful way sometimes.
Yeah. Would the idea of cultivating joy be synonymous with this loving kindness metta practice?
Absolutely. Yeah, definitely. And so actually, like, just one of the cool things about jhana is it can take so many things as object, right? Each of these jhanas can take each of these emotional qualities as object and many more. So it's not like those, you know, these are the only four emotional qualities that you can take as object. You can take joy. You can take tranquility. You know, you can take any of the seven factors of awakening. You can take any feeling you could feel that's positive. You can take gratitude. You can take those literally as jhanic object, you know, say something, you know, or bring images to mind that give you something of the bodily feel, you know, or say phrases or whatever it takes to get something of bodily feel. And then you can take the bodily feel as object and then really build those things out to something very powerful. And that can be extremely transformative, rewiring the brain in positive ways. Because again, neurons that wire, you know, fire together, wire together. And the more you reinforce these pathways, the easier it is to access them, just like any mental muscle. You know, you train to feel more gratitude, you're going to feel more gratitude. And in the same way, joy, in the same way, appreciation. So definitely all those positive qualities are very worth figuring out how to get into some jhanic state with, even if it's really light. Still, even light jhana can be very transformative and help reinforce those pathways, because the brain likes positive conditioning, and that is very positive conditioning.
Yeah. Okay. Good to know. I'm going to get back onto the loving kindness train, I think.
Heck yeah. What the world needs now is love, yeah. Sweet love.
Sorry. You can keep going. Got one more big question for you. You might laugh at it again, and if you do, that's okay.
Cool, I like to laugh.
Yeah. Everyone seems to have their own sort of idea of God or highest value. Do you have an idea of God or highest value?
So I'm not sure I see why those two things are in the same sentence.
Okay.
First of all, I don't mean to critique the question, but tell me about highest value versus God.
Are you familiar with John Lilly?
No, or I don't think so.
John Lilly was, he came around at the same time as Tim Leary and Ram Dass and all those
okay,
sort of guys.
Cool.
He invented the float tank.
Oh, wow. Okay. Yes. Okay. There you go. See, names out of context are weirdly confusing to me, as I say all the time. Yes. I've actually read some article about this and the creation of float tanks, because I have a fan who's a super float tank fan who introduced me to floating. So I've floated, yeah, I don't know, 5 or 6 times at this point. And yeah, it's really cool. I guess 6. Yeah. So
yeah, I think you've done 6 now. Oh, that's awesome. Last time I talked to you, I think you did it once and your neck popped for
an hour. It cracked and cracked the first time I did this. It was just like endless, loud, weird neck cracking for the entire thing. Yeah. It was bizarre. Yeah. That hasn't happened since, by the way, but that was my first float.
Okay. So John Lilly invented the float tank. He had some really interesting books and philosophy. He ended up going way too out in the deep end, taking ketamine and floating and trying to have telepathy with dolphins and all sorts of things. Really interesting guy. Andres from Quali Computing considered him to be a lot smarter than his contemporaries, but he didn't seem to have any peers that were on the same sort of wavelength, and hence he ended up swimming into too deeper water and sort of went off the deep end.
It happens.
It can happen, yeah. Especially if you're, you know, taking ketamine regularly in float tanks, I imagine that increases the probability. But he wrote a book called Simulations of God. And yeah, the highest value would be synonymous with God in this sense. And it's what, yeah, people consider their highest value. So he wrote a whole big giant list. Some examples would be God is money, God is death, God is humor, God is the computer, God is compassion, God simulating himself, God as eternity, God as sex, God as love, blah, blah, blah. You know, you can create a whole...
Oh, you mean, so basically the things people worship.
Exactly. Whether or not they recognize it or acknowledge it themselves, a lot of people seem to have...
So you're not using God as in like creator, omnipresent being, you know, of the universe in that kind of way.
That's another one, though. That's another one of his things that he puts us in one of the categories is yeah, God is the omnipotent creator. Okay. Or God is everything, or God is the unknown, or God is the mystery, or whatever.
Sure.
I'm curious if you have anything along those lines within yourself, if you have an idea of God, if you identify with any idea of God. You said you're agnostic, so I assume not, but do you have some kind of highest value which you would be able to prescribe, or does the question not make sense to you?
I think my highest values are clarity, honesty, and practicality, for better or for worse. And practicality has to be tempered with some sort of empathy and appreciation of other people's perspectives. Or else it's just a monster, right, of self-serving rationalization.
Yeah.
So if I was going to, you know, I can't sum it up in one word, but that would be a good start, just sort of off the cuff. If I had time to revise that, I might come up with something better, but yeah.
Okay. And do you have anything to say about the idea of God? I think I know from what you've said your philosophical base is and the agnosticism, but
yeah, I think an idea of various ideas of God can be very helpful for some people and make a practical difference in their lives.
Okay.
So that's the empirical pragmatist and the ontological agnostic all kicking in.
Yes, yes, exactly.
Yeah. And I have had some incredibly powerful experiences, so empiricism, of the sense of divine nature or everything being divine, or of being in the presence of an unbelievably grand, powerful, awe-inspiring God figure, etc. What one makes of any of those experiences, I think, is, you know, more a question of like, what's useful about them? What did they lead to that was valuable? Did they help in some way? Did they provide some additional perspective that made things somehow better? Interesting, cool, confirmatory of some ontology? I don't think so. Although I could equally argue that there is benefit to be had from believing in them ontologically as being true. So I can also, from a sort of empirical pragmatic point of view, rationalize just as easily that fully buying into one of those ontologies could be of great empirically pragmatic value.
Yeah. All right. I got a couple of transhumanist questions to finish off, because that's kind of the fun buzz about this thing. These are going to be a bit lofty and a bit weird. Take them with a grain of salt and a bit of humor, and yeah, you'll be fine. Neuralink. You've heard about Neuralink, right?
Tell me about Neuralink.
Neuralink is Elon Musk's answer to the AI alignment problem, which I assume you've heard of as well.
Keep talking. Is this, you mean talking about embedded electronics in the brain that are going to connect us to the web and upgrade our consciousness and intellectual capabilities? Is this what you're talking about?
Yeah, ultra high bandwidth computer brain interface thing with literally billions of very, very small electrodes that would allow the brain to directly interface with computers and, yeah, supposedly networked computers.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So the reason he's building this is because he's concerned with the emergence of some kind of super intelligent AI that wouldn't be aligned necessarily with humanity.
Well, I'm not sure we're necessarily that well aligned with humanity either, but go on.
Yeah, I agree. But maybe in the explicit sense, and that it would just wipe us all out.
We probably just don't want the competition for that ecological niche.
Yeah, probably not.
Just being real about this.
No, I agree. I totally agree. So his answer to that, you know, the AI alignment problem would be that we merge with it as it emerges, and hence it is us and we are it, and therefore there is no AI alignment problem.
That's so cute. Like, they're so cute. Like, it's so sweet. Like, in this, like, childlike, naive, crazy dreamer kind of way.
All right. Expand on that. I'm curious. Okay, firstly, like, tell me, you must have heard the future fear of super intelligent AI or even narrow AI.
Oh, yeah,
AI,
singularity,
right?
And, like, and beyond, et cetera. Yeah, yeah, sure. And a perfectly reasonable thing to think about. I don't know that it'll actually be intelligence, but highly sophisticated machine learning algorithms that are then
tweaked to ends that from our or any individual perspective or one's individual perspective might not seem optimal or, you know, be unbelievably destructive or whatever. Yeah.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
Whether or not machine learning is the same as actual cognitive intelligence, like is silicon cognizant? What is consciousness? How do you even measure it? How would you know? Like those are, again, deep ontological problems, but go on.
Yeah, that's what I mean. So are you skeptical that whatever emerges will be truly conscious and online?
I'm very skeptical of how you would know. So for example, if someone said, right to Matt, prove that my computer is conscious or not conscious. You tell me the experiment that does that.
So this is the interesting thing about Neuralink, right? If somehow it did properly interface with these machines, whether or not that would have some sort of conscious overlap with the technology or not.
Well, just recognize that the brain you're then wiring to some very powerful computer is mostly lizard brain. And most of our decision-making is primal and self-serving as much as we retrospectively rationalize it as being civilized and reasonable, right? Mm. So just recognize that if you think that solves some sort of ethics problem, good fucking luck with that.
Yeah, right. Unless the machines can somehow supersede the lizard brain and control it, but then you're into some pretty weird territory, and the alignment problem sort of.
Yeah, and back. Who's writing that code, and what personality? What percentage of them have a personality disorder? Right, that like, you know, it's going to be 5 or 10% or something, and then you know,
and then that's within the whole thing, the whole super emergent crazy AI thing has cluster B things built into it.
Right.
Again.
Yeah, sure. Right. And again, not all cluster B things are bad, right? I'm not, but some of them are mind-bogglingly bad, right? So good luck. Yeah. And and the other problem is if you think the network that you're plugging into is going to be a unified network with no controversy or no divisions or no, you know, conflicts, or no spin-off networks that then are not tied in and controlled by someone else, well, of course, this is just going to be the same human dramas played out with more and more elaborate tech.
Yeah, it's the space that I imagine people such as yourself or very high-level meditators that have experience in very different states and powerful concentration could potentially do a lot of good in if it ends up being an actual thing. If purely by... In the same way that we can browse the internet and have a causal effect on the internet, if by plugging into this thing, you can have a causal effect on the whole thing and manage to explore it safely and not, you know, get completely overwhelmed by it or destroyed by it. I love this really fucking sci-fi out there future shit because it's interesting and coming out there. Yeah.
I think there's my favorite sci-fi fantasy author who I think you all should read lots of, by the way, is Jack Vance. The greatest writer of the last century that nobody's ever heard of. No, actually, in his day, he was well known. He was there with Philip K. Dick, who, you know, of course, wrote things like, you know, what eventually became Blade Runner and stuff like that. And anyway, so and a bunch of other cool sci-fi movies. But he had a series, which I highly recommend, called The Demon Princes. And in The Demon Princes, there's an organization called The Institute. And The Institute is this pan-galactic organization that is basically kind of like some weird extra-governmental version of like the Masons mixed with some like paramilitary fringe groups mixed with, you know, Illuminati mixed with God knows what or something that is basically its entire singular mission is to do whatever it takes to keep the level of technology below the level at which a lone madman can end all life on a world.
Hmm. Hmm.
And it destabilizes governments, it screws up scientific experiments, it causes, you know, economic chaos, whatever the heck it takes to keep technology below that level. And if we don't have something like the Institute, then it is simply a matter of time before a single person with appropriate technology ends all of our lives. Right?
Right.
Anyway, so when I think about these scenarios, it is nearly impossible to imagine that as technology progresses and the stakes get higher and the capability of lone, crazy, destructive individuals gets high enough, it's just a matter of time before the whole thing goes boom.
Yeah, I'm inclined to agree.
Don't mean to be cynical, but it's hard to imagine any other outcome.
It's quite miraculous that we haven't had nuclear winter already. So,
yeah. Right. And, you know, what some Russian sub-captain that we owe all our lives right?
Yeah.
As came out in the Cuban Missile Crisis. That's the only reason we're all here. Thank God for the Russian who had the moral integrity not to end life on the planet. Yeah.
All right. Last time we had a few of those, like, you know, if you could be a bat, have bat wings and blah, blah, blah. We had some of those questions, and I've got like a sort of expanded transhumanist sci-fi one for you to finish off.
How fun.
All right. So, we're fast forwarding to Earth 500 years from now. Many species have died out and many are thriving in the new ecological space. And I'll add a caveat now that from the last question, there haven't been any technologies yet developed that can destroy anything in a lone wolf, or something like the Institute has been implemented. Several large post-human groups have emerged. And so these groups are the uploaded. So this group all uploaded their consciousness to a Neuralink-like hive mind. No one comes back. There are both incredible and terrifying rumors as to what it is like to be in the hive mind. The hive mind offers a singularity-like wondrous connected reality, but many do not trust it. So that's the first group, the uploaded. Second group are the primitivists. So this group wholly rejected gene manipulation and most of the technological progress, chose to retain Homo sapien genetics and a reclusive primitive lifestyle deep in the forest. They retain basic technological progress such as medicine, but choose to live as their ancestors lived. The edited. This group uses gene editing and technology to become augmented post-humans with extrasensory capabilities and dramatic physical changes. They are a large and varied group that somewhat resemble humans, embrace technology and highly personalized physical bodies, but don't trust the uploaded and disagree with the primitivists. And then there's the Voyagers. This group created AI-run, life-filled colony ships and post-humans optimized for huge interstellar journeys in an attempt to seed life on other planets. They consider themselves space nomads on an important quest to overcome entropy and have no notion of returning to Earth. If you had to choose one group to join, which would it be and why?
Wow, that is such a fun question. That is like such my idea of an extremely good time. Thank you for that. It was just delightful listening to the whole scenario. Knowing myself, it is nearly impossible to imagine that I wouldn't become some of the genetically modified ones. Almost certainly, just knowing my own personality and quirks, I could give various rationalizations for why I, you know, post hoc rationalizations for why that was the one that just called to me. But I don't know if you've read the Altered Carbon series, but I definitely do not trust what might necessarily happen in a digital matrix and the possibility of extremely weird and horrible experiences. I could totally understand joining the primitivists because, hey, this life's not bad. Like, I'm all right. This is pretty cool. Like the Voyager is not so attractive to me. Space is likely kind of harsh and radioactive and cold and long and metal and spaceship. And it's just not my thing. But cool genetic enhancements, like, why not? As long as you're doing something hopefully semi-skillful with it. Like, I've seen so many bad diseases and I myself suffer from some various things. It would be lovely to edit out, you know, my little bit of, you know, mild connective tissue disorder or whatever other things I've got that are not so great. Like, you know, like that would be awesome. Like, why not? I don't see a problem with that. Yeah. Cool. So I'd probably join them, but I could see other choices. I'll have their pros and cons. Yeah.
Nice one.
Yeah, delightful. Thank you. That was fun.
You're welcome. Good to end it on a bit of a fun note. So Daniel, how can people find you if they haven't listened to the previous podcast? How can they find you and your work?
Yeah, so they could find me at www.integrateddaniel.info. Spelled just like you'd figure, with two D's in the middle. And you could also find a community that I think is really cool for discussing spiritual practice called the Dharma Overground at www.dharmaoverground.org. You can also find some fun stuff if you're interested in cultivating powers or joint magic or deep jhanas or all kinds of insights or cool experiences. You can listen to people's reports and instructions and have some fun at www.firekasina.org. That's www.firekasina.org, which is just an old word for an external object that uses support for concentration. That's what casino means. And also, you can find a free version of my book at www.mctb.org. That's Mastering the Core Teachings of the Buddha, for free by me, or you can buy it at booksellers. By the way, all the money that I get from that, I give to Dharma projects. I don't keep any of it for like my own, you know, self or livelihood or anything like that. I spend it all on useful, helpful things that will hopefully move the Dharma forward in some kind of way. Sometimes it's, you know, server money to support the Dharma Overground or further editing for writings or that I give away for free or whatever it is. Anyway, so those are ways you can find me. And again, this is serious. If you, for some reason, happen to have the bucks and or know somebody who might, who you think could find some serious, real neurophenomenological and or valuable research that's designed to help people basically interacting with the healthcare establishment, the psychiatric establishment, et cetera, as well as do some other cool neurophenomenological things related to deep meditation, please get in touch with me. Again, I don't want any of the money for myself. I would be connecting you with other people who have the capacity to do some great studies at some major institutions who could do some really good work in the world. So thank you. That's my last plug. Thanks for listening.
Thanks so much, Daniel.
Yeah, you're welcome. It's been really fun. Thanks for all the thought-provoking questions, and hopefully someone has found this valuable for something.